It's being 7 o'clock. We will start the meeting. Call to order. Can I have a acceptance of the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Murray, second by Mr. Danny. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It is unanimous. We'll move into the second part of item number 2, which is the walk-in period. Are there any walk-ins here this evening? Yes, sir. Come on up and give us your name and address.
My name's Tom Riley, Winter in Mine Road. I was just wondering if there's anything actively being done to resolve the impasse between Verizon Fios and the town of Situate regarding bringing Fios into the town. If you call Verizon, they say the town doesn't want it. If I call the Board of Selectmen, they say, yes, we do. So if someone isn't talking to someone else, then I'd like to know if this matter can be resolved.
Sure. Mr. Murray?
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up. We've brought that up repeatedly with Verizon. I just spoke to Town Administrator Tricia Vincasey about this last month. We have queried Verizon repeatedly. Verizon is telling us they are not interested. We have tried repeatedly for the 6 years I've been on this board to bring Verizon in. In fact, when we rewrote the Comcast contract, we made sure that it allowed competition. We didn't want to inadvertently, you know, ace Verizon out. The message we are consistently getting from Verizon is they are not interested, and that comes right from Town Administrator Vincasey talking with the appropriate people at Verizon.
And I don't know any other reason other than we're not interested.
I don't think we have the customer base or it's worth it for them. I also spoke to people at Verizon Wireless at the store about it, because they're upset, because there's all sorts of packages that Verizon Wireless can offer to residents if Verizon is in that town. So Verizon Wireless is also pressuring regular Verizon to have our town put up, but it's just not going anywhere. But I will, that's as of a month ago, and what I'll do is I'll check in and we'll get back to you again on it.
Just Mr. Riley, just to make one thing clear, I cannot stand Infinity. It goes out in my house all the time. If there's an opportunity to get Fios here, I can tell you, one Board Selectman, I'd take it in a heartbeat. So you're not, it's not coming from the town or the Board of Selectmen. We want competition, because my Comcast goes in and goes out, and my wife actually is ready to pull my hair out in addition to hers, because it's driving us crazy. So I can tell you right now, if Comcast is telling you it's the town, I'd take issue with that. It's not the town.
It's not Comcast, Verizon.
What's that?
Verizon, not Comcast.
Comcast,
yeah.
Yes. Now, the reason I brought this up is recently I went to get found my cable bill went up yet again, another $10.
Right.
When I asked about it, they said, well, it goes up every year, fiat, which is what you can do if you have a monopoly. Right.
So right. It's Tom Riley?
Yes.
Yes.
R-E-I-L-L-Y.
Yeah. Mr. Norton?
Just one quick note on it. I remember that, if I remember correctly, that the other board members have said, would constantly petition them and spoke to them. One of the reasons they gave, I believe a year or two ago, was that they have a schedule of towns that they're going to go into, and we're not on the schedule for the next year or two.
But don't you find it odd that we're completely surrounded by Verizon and we don't have it? Furthermore, I remember 10 years ago, they put in the sleeves for the fiber optic piping.
It's right.
The infrastructure is there.
As the other board members have said, believe me, no, not because of any desire in the town not to have it.
I understand that. I was just wondering if there was any resolution coming forward.
We can ask them again.
Again, my information's a month old, but you know, there may have been some progress then. I don't think so, but never hurts to check again.
And the only other thing I'd add to that is when we had our meeting out in Humorock this year, some people in Humorock actually have it.
Because they're part of Marshfield.
Because they're close to Marshfield.
Sure.
So that's adds to the frustration, but the town has absolutely nothing to do with it. We petitioned them to come here, and we're just on a waiting list, so. Mm. Wish we had a better answer for you.
As do I. Thank you, gentlemen.
Yeah. Are there any other walk-ins? Yes, ma'am.
My name's Paula Reed, and I live at 34 North River Road, and I'm just, I just wanted to leave some letters for, read the health insurance, the decision you made about the health insurance, because I work at Wapatuck Elementary School, and we're just not happy with it. So I was just going to leave some letters.
Great. And I'll just talk for 2 seconds. We really can't say too much because it's in the midst of negotiations. No decision has been made yet.
Okay.
There's been, you know, committees have been meeting for at least a month. I think there's been a half a dozen meetings, and they are trying to find a common ground. We hear all your comments. We get all your letters. We get all your emails. We're sensitive to the situation, and, you know, once we get some information back, then some sort of decision will be made.
Okay. Well, I'll just leave the...
But you can actually leave them with Kim.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Excuse me.
Do I wait till Al Bagger makes his presentation, or shall I make mine now?
You have a presentation?
I do.
Wait 1 second. Yeah.
I believe this is, if I can...
It's dealing with the water?
Right.
Dealing with the water? Yeah, probably wait.
Yeah, are you going to stay for the whole meeting?
I'll stay as long as I have to, but if you want me to make my comments now...
We'll wait till after. We'll wait till, let him talk first, and then we'll be more informed on the subject.
Well, that was my thought.
Great.
I hope your minds won't be closed by then.
Me too. Okay, are there any other walk-ins?
They don't hear me.
Okay, I don't see any. So we'll move on to item number 3. Yes. I'm sorry.
Sorry. My name is Kathleen Cooney. I live at 24 Dunster Lane in Scituate. My husband and I have been long-term residents. We've lived here our entire lives. I've been working for the Scituate Public School System for 8.5 years, a paraprofessional. I, like a majority of the paraprofessionals that work for Scituate, work to provide our families with health care. More than half of my pay, basically two-thirds of my pay, goes towards health insurance. I'm gravely concerned about the changes that are about to take place. My husband has been battling non-Hodgkin's lymphoma for over 8 years. He has undergone round after round of chemotherapy, as well as 2 stem cell transplants, and I'm very happy to say that he's doing very well. And with God's graces, he is in remission. At this point, only time will tell. He currently is being seen at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute on a monthly basis, where he receives blood work, as well as an occasional bone marrow biopsy, a PET scan, or a CT scan to keep track of his disease. My husband has to take 6 medications during a 24-hour period in order to prevent his body from rejecting his new immune system, as well as maintain his health. My question is, what will this new plan cover for patients who have long-term medical issues and need critical care? If it wasn't for our plan, I wouldn't know how we could have covered all the cost of the procedures that my husband has gone through. This February was his 8th year anniversary from his diagnosis. It has been a very, very long road for us, for my husband, for our entire family. Now I find myself awake at night worried about our insurance. Will it cover everything it needs to cover? Will it cover everything that the diagnosis brings on? Please understand the importance of my concerns. My husband's life depends on our health insurance. 2/3 of my salary go towards health insurance. And he's been on a medical leave for 2 years. So I'm gravely concerned. We don't, as paras, make a lot of money doing our job. And I'm stuck between a rock and a hard place because I can't leave my job to get a more higher paying job because I can't go without health insurance. So please, when you make a decision on things, think of me, think of the paras, think of the people that are very sick that need their medical care, especially my husband, because his life depends on it. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for coming up. Just to answer your question, there are meetings going on, and to get some of the, we don't know the answers exactly in terms of what the plan covers and doesn't cover, but voice your opinion to them, mm-hmm. learn about what the different plans are. They're trying to be very similar to what you have now, so that there won't be a change in services. And
concern is that the amount of money that I make on a yearly basis, if they change the plan, I'm going to have to pay more out of my pocket. Will I even break even to work at my job? And I love my job. Mm-hmm. I'm in kindergarten, I do my job well, and I love it. But I don't want to leave my job because I can't afford to pay for my family. Because currently I'm not making a lot of money, so.
Well, thank you for coming in and talking to us. Okay, I'll give one last call out for...
Just respectfully, I'm John Fitzgerald, I'm the president.
Does this have to do with health insurance?
Yes, it does.
I just want to be state for the record. I'm recused on this issue, so this is the third one I kind of felt it. I just want to make sure everybody's aware of it. I'm not involved in any of the health insurance issues. So I'm going to step off the Diaz. Thank you.
And I'd like to check with the selectmen to see if it was okay for me to speak, because I'm actually a Braintree resident, but I do represent the teachers in town. I'm John Fitzgerald. I'm the president of the Scituate Teachers Association. I have actually nominated someone to be on the public employee committee, so I just wanted to check with you first.
Yeah, just one thing is, just as a reminder, what the purpose of walk-in is. Walk-ins are for requests to get on the agenda and to bring up matters that are urgent and that can be dealt with in a very, very brief fashion. We, of course, are very well aware of what's going on with the healthcare issues, but we're not going to be able to get into a debate here or a discussion or anything at all. So if you've got, like, something for 2 or 3 minutes, the previous person was speaking for about the right amount of time, something
absolutely
at that scale, that would be fine and that would be sufficient, but we're not going to comment.
Sure.
And that comment is not to be read either way, positive or negative, by anybody in the audience. It's just given the situation, what's going on right now.
And I, absolutely.
Is that appropriate?
Thank you, and thank you for letting me speak. I'd like to echo what Kathy Cooney just said. Not only am I a teacher in town and represent the teachers in town, I rub elbows every day with the bus drivers. I rub elbows every day with the people who work in our cafeterias and our paraprofessionals. Unfortunately, and perhaps unfairly, they make less money than us. The impact of, you know, potential health insurance increases will really adversely affect them. But I also would like to think of some of our younger teachers, less experienced teachers who are coming into the profession heavily laden in debt, have to get their master's degrees within 5 years, have to do a lot of that out of pocket. Last year, we tried to help the town out. We gave up a couple of furlough days and tuition reimbursement. And we do believe in the spirit of cooperation. And all that I'm asking is that you think of some of our lesser paid employees, some of our younger teachers who are making decisions between living home with their parents, getting an apartment, making decisions on cars, making decisions on what grad school they'd like to attend to, because it is mandated by the state. So I would, you know, like you to think about that, just going in the future, keep an open mind, and just be well aware that this, to be quite honest, I just got married, my wife and I are comfortable, we just bought a home. It won't affect me as much as the next person, but I'm not worried about me. I am worried about the next person. So I just wanted to convey that, and I want to thank you for letting me echo what Mrs. Cooney said. She's a colleague of mine, and the people at Hadley School couldn't live every day without someone like Kathy Cooney. And if she ever left the school, it would be nothing less and nothing short than a disaster, because she's an outstanding person. And that's the type of person I'm afraid that the health insurance gains will really adversely affect, and we'll lose that talent. So thank you so much for your time, and I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Are there any other walk-ins? Okay, John, you want to come back in, and we'll... Okay, number three is a discussion vote of a one-day wine and malt beverage license for the Bridal Expo. Hi, come on up. How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. Tell us your name and address and
what
you want to do.
My name is Terry Martini. I live at 8 Edgewood Road. I own the Front Street Gourmet at 121 Front Street, and I am a participant in the Scituate Bridal Expo to be held on the 25th of this month from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. My choice for beverage is to be tasting, not pouring. I will be tasting champagne and a red wine and a white wine. So my my position here today is just to present you with what I am doing and seek approval.
What's the difference between tasting and pouring? And are you saying, you said you're tasting.
You're
not drinking it, obviously, I mean, but what do you mean by that for the board's edification?
For clarification, it means that it would be a 1 ounce pour, so, as opposed to three or 4 ounce glass.
Do you do it, or does somebody else pour, or who pours?
I have acquired the representative from one of my companies. Monsieur Tuton is one of the wine companies, and they're graciously going to be coming to pour for me.
I got you.
So I did get, which Kim has, here is a copy of my insurance covering myself.
Yep.
And they also, I wasn't able to get that in time, but I will have it. They are also covered. So we have dual coverage for insurance purposes.
And Kim, have they met all the requirements of?
Yes.
The only question that I had was the hours that you said aren't the hours that are on this form. It says 11 to 3. So what hours are you?
The tasting will not start until after 12. I wasn't sure if that fell in line with the Massachusetts, even though we're tasting and restaurants can serve, you know, right before 12 o'clock, but I just kept it till after 12. The Bridal Expo, itself will be starting at 11, and we probably won't get out of there till 4 o'clock.
Okay, so do you want that
the whole time
to go
to
4,
that
I guess is my question?
For my purposes, you can end at 3.
And 12, can it start at 11? Can we give them a license?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Yep. Motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a one-day beer and wine license to the Scituate Bridal Expo for a wine and champagne tasting at the Harbor Community Building at 44 Jericho Road, Scituate, on Sunday, March 25th, 2012, from 11 a.m. till 3 p.m.
I'll second if I may just make a comment. Again, this, and I have no problem with, somewhere down the road, there will be a policy, and I don't know what that policy will be as far as the entire use of that building.
Mm-hmm.
But, we do not have a policy right now, so you certainly are under that time frame.
I do have another question before the second. Is my coverage covering the entire Bridal Expo? In other words, I don't want responsibility for anyone other than Front Street Gourmet as far as alcohol pouring.
Yeah, you'd have to talk to the insurance company, but I'm not sure I even understand your question.
If somebody comes in there and they have alcohol, that's illegal. They're not allowed to. The only person who's authorized is you.
Because the way that was stated, it was the Scituate Bridal Expo, not Terry Martini, Front Street Gourmet.
Ah.
So I just want to make sure that if anybody else walks in and they start pouring something, that I'm not supposed to be covering them.
Good point. So why don't we did second that, so why don't we...
I'll withdraw my second.
Let me do this. Let me move to amend. Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant...
Wait one second.
Oh, I'm sorry.
For Kim.
I was going to say. I'm just going to amend the motion, Kim.
Okay.
And it's going to be moved that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a one-day beer and wine license to the Front Street Gourmet for a wine and champagne tasting at the Harbor Community Building located at 44 Jericho Road, Scituate, on Sunday, March 25th, 2012, from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m.
Correct.
Second by Mr. Norton. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
It is unanimous 3-0. And just while we're on this subject, not for you're all set, but just for people questioning about the community center on Jericho Road, that process, although it's taken a little bit of time, is coming to the next stage. That'll be on a future meeting for us to discuss, to figure out what the use of that building is going to be, which I think John or Joe brought up. You know, that may change very shortly, whether people, it's available to be rented right now, but that may be, you know, a playground in 2 months. So, you know, we are going to be taking the next steps to find out what that building's use will be, and it should be within the next month or so.
March 27th meeting, the committee will be presenting to the Board of Selectmen their findings after.
There you go. 2 weeks they'll be presenting to us, so.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, move on to item number 3A. Which is a common vicular's license for Nona's Homemade Ice Cream. How are you?
Very well, Mr. Chairman, Selectman. Thank you for seeing me this evening. My name's Thomas Donahue. I live at 72. I'm a homeowner at 72 Gannett Road, along with my wife, Kristen, and 4 kids. They're in it too. We own and operate Nona's Homemade Ice Cream Shop. We've been in the business since 1999. We've been known as since 2001. So we recently celebrated our 11 years, making our own stuff. As some of you may know, we have a mobile unit, which were permitted each year for the beaches, home events, neighborhoods, and such here in Scituate. And what we're petitioning for right now is to open a year-round location at 1 Millworf Plaza, the old site, the former site of Harbor Scoops. And we'd like to do so this weekend, and I'm here to seek a common vic license.
Great. Any questions from the board? So you're taking over the spot, just so everybody knows, behind the movie theater, formerly
yes.
Harbor Scoops, known as is in Hingham?
Yes. We make our own stuff right. There.
It's great ice cream.
And we'll bring it. Thank you very much. It's I don't know how I got into the business. You'll have to ask my wife. She'll tell you that. And we currently employ half of our staff in Hingham are Scituate kids because we've lived in Scituate for 10 years. And we have interviewed and hired 20 Scituate kids in the last 3 weeks. So a lot of Scituate High School is going to be represented very well down at the harbor. Should it go our way.
My babysitter has worked there for years. So, Mr. Murray.
Yeah, I and my four kids are likely to be heavy clients of yours, customers of yours. Are you planning on being year-round? And I'm just curious.
Yes. I understand that it wasn't year-round before.
That's correct, yeah.
It's a year-round operation. Yeah. We have a lot of people working. We have a general manager.
Yeah.
It's my wife's full-time job.
Yeah, that's great.
I'm in the night part of it, and I do some of the truck stuff. And
sure.
We have a lot of we actually have a lot of college kids from Scituate who do a lot of the driving, do a lot of managing at nighttime.
It's but a great
we
location.
We plan on running it right through, including January and February,
yep.
The lean months.
Yeah.
So yes, we want to give it a go. We think we can make it successful, and we have a lot of connections. We have four kids in Wampatuck, and we have my oldest is in the sixth grade, my youngest is full day in kindergarten. So twice a year our truck is there, so we're already built in with the schools, and we plan on doing fundraisers with all four elementary schools, and that's the way that we advertise.
Yeah, it's great.
I wish you luck. It's going to be great.
Thank you. I need it, so thank you very much, Mr. Danny.
Just one last question. Are you going to serve anything other than ice cream there?
It's going to be ice cream, Mr. Chairman, ice cream cakes, baked goods, and we're looking at soups. That's not definite right now. But what it's not going to be is Scituate's, sub sandwiches or regular sandwiches or anything like that. Coffee we'd like to get on the menu also.
Great.
Motion.
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a common vic license to known as homemade ice cream, 1 Millworf Plaza, and upon successful inspection by the board.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danny. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Good luck this weekend.
Chairman, Selectman, thank you very much. I appreciate you seeing me this evening.
Stop by
there. It's going to be a crazy week.
That's good.
So we'll move on to item number 4, which is a discussion, possible vote for Go Green Landscape Supply, Inc. lease. Tim?
Hey, guys.
How are you?
Good. The girls are up by 2 with 3 minutes left, in case you were wondering.
I was.
In the garden. My name's Tim Lopes. I live at 10 Lincoln Avenue in Scituate. I also own Go Green Landscape Supply at 167 Driftway. Before I start about the lease, I just wanted to congratulate the selectmen, the town administrator, DPW, Al Bangert, everybody who was involved in the turbine construction on a job well done. From someone who witnessed the construction firsthand on a day-to-day basis, it's amazing to me that a project of that magnitude inconvenienced so few. The communication between George, the site construction manager, Al Banger, to me was excellent. There were changes and there were things that happened in the course of the construction, but there were no surprises. Any change that happened that impacted me, I knew about 24 to 48 hours before it occurred. Love the turbine or hate the turbine, the construction was an incredible feat of engineering that, from my perspective, was completed flawlessly. So congratulations to you guys and to the town. When you think about the size of that and all that went into it with that little inconvenience, it's really phenomenal. So congratulations. The reason that I'm here is to talk to you about my lease. For those of you who don't know, the present lease commenced on July 1st, 2009. It's a 10-year lease, and then at the town's option, there are three additional 5-year terms that the town can implement or not implement. I'm coming to you because of a concern that I have relative to the way that the business that I'm in is structured. So to give you a sense of it, I've spent upwards of $500,000 in the first 3 years that I've been on the Driftway in capital expenditure on equipment. I anticipate spending a similar amount over the next 2 to 3 years. To spend that kind of money, knowing that in 7 years' time, the town could elect to not renew my lease after I've put in all the financial effort, the blood, sweat, the tears, then to have it potentially be voted to have my lease terminated or something else happen to it, to me is rather risky. What I would like the town to do is to take a look at the lease that the Scituate Marine Park Marine Service Center has. And at first blush, it may look like, well, what does the Marine Service Center and the composting facility have in common? They're both different businesses. Yes, they are, but at their core, they're very similar. Both of us are leasing property from the town. On that property, we're delivering enhanced services to the townspeople of Scituate. Both of us are. We both have large and ongoing capital expenditures that we have to make to stay viable and current in use of technology. We both are responsible for our viability to developing long-time repeat business over a series of years. And we're both in businesses where if the wind changes direction, somebody else could swoop in after we put in 10 years of hard work and all that business and expense and risk is mitigated and someone else can come in and take it away. So my lease is 10 years and then the town has the right at that point to renew 3 5-year options. The Marine Service lease is a 10-year lease, at which point the Marine Service Company has the right to renew the lease for another 10 years. They're very different. And I would like the selectmen to take a look at that and consider somehow getting them closer and somehow protecting me beyond the next 7 years.
Okay. Before we go, can you check your score real quick?
It's they're behind by 1 point. Sorry.
Okay.
Sorry.
20.
We've got the lease in front of us. We've looked at it. Obviously, we signed it 3 years ago. We're coming up on 3 years in a couple of weeks. The discussion is really extending it more than the 7 years that you have now. It looks like you're looking for 25 years or some bigger number than seven.
Correct.
Okay.
Or the option. In other words, you're saying, well, you'd like to have the option the way that the boatyard is the Maritime, so that they have the option after 10 years to renew.
Yeah, they're far more protected than me, and for something of this type of capital expenditure, I'm looking for more protection. Yeah.
What I'm saying, Tim, is though, in other words, you can either say you want the full 25 years, or an other option would be after 10 years, you'd have the option to continue for.
Sure. Either one of those is amenable.
Wait, actually, can I just clarify? Either one of those is fine.
Yes.
And a 10 and a 10, or a 10 and a 10 and a 5, but the key is the option is...
It's option. It's
his option.
Yeah, you're 10. He can have the option to renew it for another 5 years, or...
We could give him the first option.
Right.
Potentially. There's a lot of ways that it can be restructured.
No question.
I do have a quick question, though, in terms of the capital improvements. You mentioned that you bought a lot of equipment.
Correct.
And that's not really going to the site. Is your future improvements actually going to be built into the site itself, or is it a new grinder that essentially you could pick up and move down the street if you had to? Like, what capital improvements do you have in mind that, you know, somebody else could come in and because you're going to dig a hole that's this big that allows you to do your job? I don't know anything.
Sure. There are a number of them, and none of them that I can – I'm prohibited from doing anything without presenting it to you or the town administrator prior to.
Right.
So there are a number of things that I could potentially do. What I'm initially speaking about is capital expenditure, not capital improvements to the site, but capital expenditures that I have to make relative to equipment.
Okay, so it's your own. But you could essentially move right next door with your equipment if you had to and start there.
In theory, I could. In reality, it took 4 years to get on this site,
right.
So it's extraordinarily challenging.
Right. There's not a lot of land around. So.
Correct.
Just so we're clear as to where we stand. Any comments?
I've Hadn't considered this until Mr. Lopes and Mr. Danahy mentioned it, but I, you know, it's very clear that Mr. Lopes' business is adding a service to the town. He's open 7 days a week, whereas before we only had the option when it was down before. It's a better financial situation, certainly, than we were before we put this in. I haven't heard any complaints from anybody. In fact, quite the opposite. And I don't think, you know, I think everything's going fine there. So I like the idea of switching it so it's more in line with our other main lease in town, mainly the boatyard guys. And so I'd be comfortable with, at the end of this first 10, having it be another 10 at his option, and that's 20 years. That's less than the 25 you were asking, but I like the fact that it's still a 10 and it's up to his option.
What if we just took the first five-year option and made that your option?
My sense is that that might not.
All right.
My preference would be to make it the same as a similar business in town.
But part of the reason they had it that way is because they actually made improvements to the site that were going into the site. They weren't just buying boats. They were building structures on the site, which is a little bit different. Not, I mean, the same category, but a little bit different.
It's a little bit different, but I think at the end of the day, we're both in the exact same boat, no pun intended, relative to what could happen if the winds of change blew and the town changed the mind as to what vendor they wanted to operate. It's very easy to move one vendor out, potentially, and another vendor in, and that vendor walks into a significant business that you've spent 15 years building.
Right. But a 15-year lease is pretty good, too. But regardless, any other comments from the board?
My question to you is this, Tim. In other words, if you had the option every 5 years, because right after 10 years, it goes into a five-year option.
Mm-hmm.
And the only difference is the town has the option now, whereas
you
have the control of saying, I'll take that option for the next 5 years. You know what the base rent's going to be. Then the next, after year 15, it's your option. You know what the base rent's going to be. My question to you is, does it really make a difference whether it's 10 years or not? Because you control that 10-year period, whether you opt. You're getting more control between year 10 and year 15. If things go south for you and they don't go well, come year 14, 15, you can say, I'm opting out. I need to go somewhere else. So I would think it would be better for you to say, if I have the option, as opposed to the town, in year 10, year 15, year 20, that's even better than getting locked into a 10-year duration. See what I'm saying?
I think what you're is breaking up into smaller segments. Is that what your point is?
Right. In other words, you're asking the board, number one, I think initially to expand it to 20 for 15 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. From year 10 to year 25, you wanted to take it for the full 15 years.
Initially, I'm saying let's make it the same. Sorry. Initially, I'm saying let's make it the same as the boatyard,
okay.
Which is 10 and 10.
10 and 10.
Right.
You got a 25-year lease here, potentially.
Right.
Okay. What I'm saying to you is, from your perspective, this helps you, actually, I would think, that right now the town has the option after year 10 to say, okay, we can turn you away and turn you out.
Sure.
Or we can do that in year 15, or we can do that in year 20.
Yep.
Because the town controls that determination. Whereas if we flip it and say, you have that determination in year 10, you can decide it. You can decide that in year 15. You can decide that in year 20. It actually benefits you because instead of getting stuck into a period of 10 years, you're given 5 years.
Correct.
Okay?
But I only suggested the first year, not all three options. I was suggesting giving him one
for
the first one.
For just five, for
right, so
15.
He'd have 15, and then in years,
15,
the next
and
two
20.
Would still be the town's.
I see.
Is what I suggest, but
that seems short to me.
15 years?
Yeah, it does, because, I mean, it takes a long time to do these businesses, and we're trying to make a commitment to a locally owned business that's doing a great job. And just like the other one, and I can certainly see, I mean, he's been in there for 3 years already, so it's only another 12. And so if you go to a 15, and so I'd be more inclined to add 15, which is basically bringing it up to the 20, which is a 10 and a 10, or 10 and a 5-5, or whatever. I mean, I understand your point, John, and I'm fine with that too, personally.
Mr. Cafferty?
I, I just want to hazard the board on this. This went out as a public bid project for possible land, and I just talked to maybe town council before we change the stipulations of the lease, because it's liable to come back at us and get sued by the second or third bidder on this. And that's all I want to say before any terms are changed.
That's a very good point. And I think we're heading that direction anyways.
Actually, we have a letter from town council here. He's gone through this. He's advised us that we have the ability to do this lease. It's in our packet.
Sorry.
Nope, no problem.
Well, the
And town council would oversee anything that we agree to anyways, again, but, you know.
So I guess the point is that we, we have a news flash real quick. Shannon Brady just tied the game at the buzzer, and it's gone into overtime. Although, you must have a better phone system than me, because you came earlier. Not to belittle the conversation here. I, from what I hear, I think that the board is open to some sort of restructuring. Whether it's 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, I don't know, and I don't know that we have to come to that answer tonight, but we can certainly beat it around and see where do you want to be, where do we think it is, and then go from there. You know, would you like the responsibility for 25 years on that space?
Ultimately,
so,
yes.
So you'd have this lease, you'd be...
Just flip those. I mean, John's idea makes perfect sense.
And so that's your high end. What's your low end?
My low end would be to mimic the... Would be to emulate the lease that the Marine Center has.
That's essentially a 10 and a 10?
Correct.
So if we rewrote the lease right now and gave you 10 years with the town having a 10-year option afterwards?
Five. No.
Five. No.
He has
I have the option.
No, you said a 10 and a 10, so he has an option after the next 10.
It's his, correct.
I just see that giving you a little more protection if you have the option, whether it be 5 or 10. I mean, I like John's idea. I didn't think of that idea before. But that way, again, we certainly hope nothing happened.
Mm-hmm.
If something did happen, you wouldn't want to be sitting in this first or second year of a 5-year lease.
Mm-hmm.
And wondering how you're going to get out of it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the idea of you having the option to get out, or not to renew it, makes sense. That's all.
So how about at the end of this 10, a 5 and a 5, but your option? Both of those 5s are your option.
Does it starting now that the clock starts on the 10, or already the or
no, at the end of 10, so you've got 7 to go to the end of 10.
With
and then there'd
options.
Be a 5-year option for you.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of that, 5-year option for you.
Mm-hmm.
You'd have 17 years.
Mm-hmm. That would work.
So that's another 17 from now.
Mm-hmm.
But both options are controlled by you. Does that work?
That works.
I'll put that forward as a sense of emotion.
Now, should we talk to, I don't know if Tricia would have any input on this. I didn't talk to her about this before she left, and she's on vacation this week. Do you want to?
Well, she.
I read it.
Yeah, she's been in touch with town council, and town council says the board at its discretion may extend the lease, da-da-da. There's nothing in the lease which prohibits the board from this. What we could do is we could make, if we want, because I'd like to get this as resolved as possible so we don't keep going back and forth, make the motion contingent upon approval of the town administrator and town council.
Whatever the sense of the board is.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. Just get it done tonight, and then the input from town council, if they want us to readjust it or change it, we can do it. So I'd say vote tonight that way.
So essentially what we're going to do,
10, 5 and 5.
So we'll remove the last option and take the first and second options and give them to him. Right, he's three
yeah,
options.
I guess he's got three. You got 3 5-year options now, so we'd make 2 5-year options, but they're yours.
Mm-hmm.
So this is how it would work.
How would that word?
Okay.
How that
after the 10th year, you'll have the option to renew for another 5 years. At the end of 15 years, because that's the additional 5 years,
mm-hmm.
you'll have the option to renew for another 5 years. After the 20th year, then the town will have the option to renew
mm-hmm.
for the final 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
You understand that? That's,
I
that's
do.
The proposal. Okay.
Yep.
I'm fine with either. If you're fine with that, that's fine with me.
Okay.
Whatever
you fine with that?
That works for me.
And
thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I think this might take care of Kevin's concern too, because we're not changing the lease, we're letting the lease go for the full 10 years.
Correct, it's only, it's just the,
really
the
just
options.
Changing options right. One and two.
We can't change the term of the lease, because I think that would be material, and that would put us afoul of what Kevin raised with potential contractually RFPs, the whole nine yards, so.
So let's talk.
So I've made
we'll
that motion.
Make a motion, and then we'll talk to Trish about it and finalize it, you know, when she gets back.
Okay.
I made the motion.
Second by Mr. Norton. Further discussion. I just want to reiterate that you do a great job there. You provide a service to the town, so this isn't like the town giving you a piece of property. You're actually, you've taken an operation that we don't have to manage out of the transfer station and into you, and obviously you provide, you know, the mulch and all the services that you provide there to the town, mm-hmm. You know, in a local operation. So none of this has any, you know, any recourse in terms of what you're doing. I think you do a great job there.
And just so that people understand, you know, the rents, year one was $30,000, year two was $42,000, year three was $72,000 that you're paying annually, and year four is on top of that, and it goes up. So it's not like it's short money we're dealing with here. We're dealing with serious rent that the town's getting paid by somebody who helps the town and also makes a business and a living. So,
so further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. So we'll get this wrapped up in a week or two when Trisha gets back.
Great. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Public hearing at 7:30 for street acceptance.
Oh, great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you, Tim.
Thanks, Tim.
So why don't we move to item number... We'll skip the number seven, the street acceptance. Public hearing at 7:30.
Thank you.
How are you, Al?
Good evening. This is a posted public meeting for two streets that are being proposed for acceptance as public ways. The property owners along each of the, both of these streets have been informed by certified mail at least 7 days prior of your intentions to hold a public hearing, and this meeting was posted in a public place. The board appointed a street acceptance committee. This the applicants for Ava's Lane and Lauren's Lane applied to the street acceptance committee for acceptance. The street acceptance committee looked at the streets. We conclude that they meet the town standards as they are today. They also meet the requirements of the planning board for their permit to build this subdivision. This is a new subdivision approved in 2006. The streets are currently under the control of the developer, which is Sam Tilden Farm LLC, who is applying on behalf of the budding property owners for the acceptance of these two streets as public ways. And the streets meet, as I say, all planning board and DPW requirements.
Discussion? Just to reiterate that it did go through the street acceptance process, and it will probably be on the next town meeting to have the town actually, the town will vote to accept
it. Yeah, in April.
In April.
On a motion?
Mr. Murray?
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to order the layout of Ava's Lane as a public way, said way bounded and described in accordance with the description and plan to be filed in the office of the town clerk at least 10 days prior to the annual town meeting.
Second.
Discussion. Do we have the right names, Kim and Al? I remember, is it Ava's Lane
and
Lauren Lane? Just so that we're clear, because I remember
that's
there was
correct.
A... Okay, good.
Yes.
I'll make sure.
Second by Mr. Norton. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to order the layout of Lauren Lane as a public way, said way bound and described in accordance with the description and plan to be filed in the office of the town clerk at least 10 days prior to the annual town election, town meeting.
Second by Mr. Norton. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous 4-0. Thank you, Al.
Thank you.
Do you get to stay there? Or we
no, he's
move
around.
Back to item number
five.
Thank you.
See you, Eddie.
Which is the discussion of the sidewalk paving on Stockbridge Road.
Good evening.
Devin, how are you?
Very good. Thank you. What we're putting before, we went out to bid for the sidewalk for Stockbridge Road, and we got some pretty good bids, and we're here to get the contract awarded with the selectmen.
Great. If you can just... A couple questions I had is when is it going to actually go in?
If we get the approval now, we'll proceed. We're waiting on the contractor to provide his performance bond and certificate of insurance and his labor and materials bond. After we receive that, we'll get a pre-construction meeting going, and we will proceed with the project.
So you think it would start in?
So we would award it hopefully within 2 to 3 weeks, and they could start work right after that.
In the spring, then?
Yes.
And just what side of the road is it going on?
Actually, the plan is right up there. We put the plan together and posted it right up there.
Zach, can you get that? Sorry, I'm just wondering if they can see it on TV.
And that shows along Stockbridge Road. This is where the base bid was, where we originally thought we would have enough money to come up to here. The bids came in pretty low, so we will be able to go up to the ad alternate, which is on BS Lane. And here's the Jenkins School over there.
That's right, excellent. So it's on the side of the cemetery, the whole way?
Correct. There's no crossing or anything else. It came up briefly before, and I figured it'd be a lot easier if we had a nice picture that could show how it goes.
Yeah.
And we'll leave that up here if any but residents want to come in and take a look at it and see how it's here. We've already had a couple meetings with the residents.
So there'll be crosswalks on, like, Greenfield and so on?
There's crosswalks and handicap ramps, updated handicap ramps and everything else on those.
Great. Are we doing just white stripe crosswalks these days? Or we talked a while ago about having the green ones?
They are downtown, or down in the harbor, I think, Al, right?
Yeah.
I don't know if we're still doing it or not, but we had done it for a few years.
Just the tiger stripe. The town standard is the tiger stripe crosswalk.
Okay. No longer green. Okay.
Can I ask why, Al, is there a reason why the stripe instead of the green? Is there a reason why instead of we're not having green anymore?
The green is actually a slip hazard. Problem with the green wears out, it's a slip hazard, it's a lot more expensive. The white we can do in thermoplastic, which is much more durable. Thermoplastic has like a 5-year reflectivity life, whereas paint is reflective only for about a year, and then with a few snow plowings, it's no longer visible. So you end up with a longer lasting, more visible, and safer crosswalk with this white tiger striping.
Thank you.
Great.
Wow. That's one thorough answer.
Any other discussions?
Just want to say that I'm ecstatic about this. You know, I know that this has been a project that we've talked about for a number of years since the sidewalk, and all the not just the children, but the residents on Stockbridge and around Stockbridge should be very happy. It's going to be a really bonus and a benefit to them, because that is a very narrow road, and it's dangerous, and you're covering at least portions of a lot of neighborhoods, so congratulations, and it's good for the town.
It's to a destination.
Yep.
It took us a little longer with the permitting, where Stockbridge Road is such an old road. We had a lot of problem with survey on each individual lot. There was no typical right-of-way. Each individual lot varied on how they fell in, so it was tricky getting the sidewalk in, and it took additional time. But we have it, and we're ready to go.
Good. Motion?
Motion, Mr. Chairman. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to award the contract for the Stockbridge Road Sidewalk Improvements Contract 12-SW-02 to Century Paving and Construction Corp. of Fall River, Mass. For a total bid price of $228,961.15, with payment to be made at the unit price and or lump sum prices pending receipt of a certificate of insurance, 100% performance, and 100% labor and materials bond.
Second.
Second by Mr. Danahy. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It is unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you. Move on to item number 6, which is a discussion vote and a contract awarding to Seawall Engineering. Mr. Cafferty?
This is for, I think it was town meeting a while back. Money was approved through CPC to do repairs to the seawall at the lighthouse and improve that entire area. We put out to bid, or we sent out an RFP to a bunch of different engineering firms to look into the seawall and come up with a way to better protect A, the parking lot, and B, the lighthouse. We sent it out to 5 firms. One was non-responsive, and we have the prices listed for the other 4 firms. We found Coastline Engineering's proposal to be the most responsive. And we are suggesting that the Board of Selectmen award the contract to CLE Engineering of Marion, Mass. For an amount of $52,610.
Discussion?
Motion?
Well, one thing we do have is we have another picture. We've got a lot of visual arts here tonight. And we have another picture of what we plan on doing.
The blue area?
The blue is we'd look to do stonework in that area around the lighthouse and build the stonework up. The other option that we're looking at is either a potential concrete wall or a stone wall on the parking lot side to help protect that and raise the grade up a couple feet. One of our fears that we have, or every storm we have, we seem to have a lot of water. Rocks fill all our drainage, and the parking lot really gets hammered. So we're hoping by raising the grade a couple feet, one way or the other, we will we'll alleviate some of that and protect some of the area.
So are you looking for like a seawall that's going to be higher than the riprap that's presently there?
Yes.
As a part of the seawall, are you guys considering having at least, I know seawalls are not meant for, they're seawall, foreshore protection, I understand that, but mm-hmm. the ability at least when it's decent weather to be able to have stairs that go up on top of the wall for people to take a look out, because it creates literally a barrier for the parking lot during good times. That's
I mean, I've been there myself, and I can't see over that edge the way it is now. So what we were looking for, you'd still have the walking access the way it was before, and we've looked at a couple different options. We've looked at concrete walls with maybe some sort of stone facade on it, so it would look similar to where it is, but it is in the planning stages, and every time you open up a stairway like that, you've got potential water flow coming back in. So
not on the ocean side. I'm talking about from the parking lot. So at least people want to get up to walk down.
We haven't finalized the plans. We're going to look at it, and then we're probably going to have to do additional permitting. We might have to do additional. We might even have to do permitting with the Corps for this. But our thought process was have the concrete wall and then have the stone come over and go naturally into it. So it's one of the things that we're looking at.
That's on the ocean side.
That's on the ocean side.
On the ocean side.
He's
yes.
talking about getting some. I think what John's thinking is we don't want people trying to climb up on it.
Right.
And possibly falling if there's some sort of stairwell.
On the parking lot side to walk up to the top of the wall.
We don't have anything planned for that
okay.
as of now.
Is that on the seawall committee? Is that going to go back to the committee for, or is that in-house with the?
Actually, we had the seawall committee. Dave Ball helped us pick Coastline Engineering because we put it out to, we had four different people review all four proposals that we received and come up with the best rated engineering firm. And then we opened up the prices and evaluated how it was. And Coastline had one of the better things, but it will be discussed in the seawall committee when we have a finalized plan, and we will go over this at our next meeting, which is Friday.
I'll talk Friday then.
That's okay. Fine.
Yeah.
Just to follow up and mm-hmm. reiterate, anything to do to enhance public access is desired. Okay, because the barriers are needed and helpful and required, and that's first and foremost. But we really don't want to end up barricading ourselves in. And I don't just mean aesthetically with a sight line, but public access so people can get up and walk around as much as possible.
Mm-hmm. I don't think we'll be limiting that from what's there now. With any luck, hopefully by the time the project's complete, it'll be improved.
Great, thanks.
I noticed that CPC, the articles were $475,000.
Correct.
And we're only spending about 50.
Correct.
So is that... That other stuff will go for other seawall repair?
No, that actual, the 475, I think, that was allocated. Of that, the 52,000's engineering, the
quarter afterwards
would be to do the actual work. And what we were going to do is we figured that would be over $450,000 by the time we're done
right.
to repair that. We would supplement that with some of the seawall money from the override to make that work.
Yeah, I wasn't thinking. You actually have to buy the stones and stuff.
And hire a contractor and go out to bid and see where it goes. And depending on what the findings are, if it's a concrete wall or a stone wall or riprap revetment.
Sure. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to award the contract for engineering for seawall repairs at the lighthouse at Cedar Point to CLE Engineering of Marion, Massachusetts for a total price of $52,610.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous, 4-0.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin. Bring up to the board, and I probably should have done it earlier, we are going to have an electronic waste day March 31st from 9 to 3 at the transfer station, and there will be no charge for any TVs, consoles, electronics that people may have coming in. We worked that out with the South Shore Consortium, helped us work that out with a contractor, and there's no cost to the town.
Did you say March 31st?
March 31st, and
that's a Saturday?
It's through the transfer station,
from
yes.
From 9 to 3?
Yep.
I know last time it was a
computers,
big success.
TVs.
Last time we were able to do it for half price. This time we were able to negotiate it with the contractor because we're in that South Shore consortium and we're able to do it as a larger group, get it for no cost at all. So right. it's a decent savings.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you. We've done item number 7. Item number 8 is the cable television budget. Come on up, guys. Before we do that, unfortunately, I have a little bit of bad news. High school girls basketball team lost in overtime. But they had a phenomenal season.
I actually have a little PowerPoint set up here and even a little video as well. We'll see how this goes.
Now I got a question as you're doing this, John. Sure. Now that we have the new cameras, can Zach, instead of queuing it in a box, can he actually split the TV?
He's going to be simultaneously working on that computer to do the PowerPoint live on TV, so we don't have to train the cameras on the TV. It's actually going directly from the computer to the...
You guys look much better, too, I might add.
Thinner. lot thinner and younger.
Yes. So, what's up a second? Okay, so let's start from the beginning. Hello, Selectmen. I figured I'd go and introduce myself and say a little bit about what's going on with cable and just a quick kind of roundup, and then maybe do a little bit of catch up on just what's happening, and then we can talk about the budget. My name is John Roser, and I'm the Executive Director of Scituate Community Television. This has been a very productive year for cable TV in Scituate. When I started working on this project 2 years ago, there was no cable studio, no TV cameras, and no home for community television in our town. Room 104B at the Scituate High School is being utilized as a storage room. It is now a fully functional contemporary TV studio that is creating on-site programming, as well as providing resources to record local performances, news, and events. I always tell people that community television is a win-win situation for everybody. Cable TV does not use tax money for its annual budget. It is completely funded by a contract agreement with the cable providers in the area. In our case, it is a contract with Comcast. Comcast is required by federal mandate to appropriate a certain percentage of their revenue specifically for cable TV. Over the last 2 years, with the help of the Cable TV Advisory Committee, the Selectmen, the Selectmen Liaison, the Town Administrator, Superintendent of Schools, Dr. Martin, Principal Nuzzo, the high school maintenance staff, and yes, a host of students and volunteers, we have created a working TV studio in room 104A and B at Scituate High School. The last step in this process was the installation of a safety platform, which I'll show here in a sec, in the back of the studio. This means the studio is now fully installed as of 2 weeks ago and is now open to any citizen with an interest in cable TV and or the use of community television resources. Our studio is available for meetings, community outreach, informal tours, as well as workshops and classes. It is true space is limited, which impacts our ability to accommodate some potential needs for our community, but many classes at Scituate High School are starting to use SCTV 10 as a resource for class assignments. In addition to students, our outreach has included parents, school faculty, and administration on a daily basis. We have provided resources and broadcast time for the Scituate Friends of Music, the South Shore Theater, the South Coast Men's Hockey League, South Shore Vocational Tech, Council on Aging, and many, many others. We are working with the Scituate Rec Department to develop a TV production workshop, and the studio looks great now. We have TV cameras, editing stations, a green screen, pro lighting, and a control room with tech support. Let's see if we can get this thing going. Many local events, performances, and activities, which have been recorded by SCTV camera operators and broadcast on both channels 10 and 22.
Yes.
I might have to start it here. So, come on, but I can do it. We have many citizens and students involved with Situate Community Television. I encourage anyone who is watching this and who would like more information to email us at sctv@town.situate.ma.us. So that's it, and then should I read the mission statement? Is that?
We read it. I
mean, okay.
We have all the material.
Good, so good. Excellent.
Tell us what you've done and what you want to do.
Well, what we've done is created a studio, and we are working with the school and citizens, and I mean, we literally just put in this safety platform, and it's probably being shown right now. Let me see if I can get the cursor. See it there. It's kind of hard to see up there.
The slideshow.
Yeah. Maybe Al can help me with that. What we want to do is kick this.
No.
Yeah, see, there you go. What we want to do is provide resources for our community. I mean, I feel like we're at a place now where we've been looking to be a resource that has lendable equipment, for example, for people that want to do their own projects and create programming. That's the ultimate goal, is to reflect this community. All the performances, events, sports. That I've talked to Coach Devine about getting, you know, people covering sports events, and there's so much planning. It's really a matter of executing now that we have this thing put together. It's exciting.
It is. It's great. We've been talking about it for years.
Yes. Yes.
Literally.
So we want to get, you know, we want to get more meetings on air.
Yes.
Live. We want to get more community events. Has there been a lot of more than just an elementary school basketball game, people coming to you to provide content? I mean, that's always been our concern, where there is actually content coming to you so that, you know, so
yes. Yes. In fact, last week alone, we had the Department of Health did that opiate panel at Scituate High School, and we covered both morning and night of that event. The sixth graders that was great. The Selectmen's meeting happened. The Scituate Dancing with the Stars happened that previous weekend. I mean, we're getting. There's an application online that everybody can find out, whoever's watching this now can see that there's on the town website and our little web page there at SCTV10, there's now an application for event coverage, so that if you have an event or a performance that you'd like us to go and record, we can do that. I put two producers on the payroll, one of them being Zach back there, who we're now in a position to start recording more meetings and get that kind of scheduling going on. I mean, my primary focus is the programming of Channel 10, and I'm also starting to assume responsibilities for Channel 22 as well, because that's been Rich Long's purview. But you know, I think that's slowly going to be consolidated. I think that's a good idea to have a cable center and a focus there instead of kind of being at disparate places. So all those things are my primary job, you know, what's on TV right now. Because I now I'm starting to get the staff, and now I actually have the studio to create the programming. Now it's just opened up the whole thing. And so all the things that I've been only able to do myself, to cover all the events and all the performances that people ask me to do, that I've been doing myself. You've seen me going around town. I now can literally, you know, I have a staff, I'm building, it's happening, slowly but surely.
Any comments, discussion? Mr. Mark?
I just have a procedural question. Are we voting this budget tonight, or are we taking this under advisement as we have with other budgets and so on?
Yeah, we can do that.
Yeah,
are we voting it tonight? Or?
No, I don't think we'll vote it. I think we'll review it and get their feedback. And get our questions answered, then go from there, so we can get, you know, Tricia can be involved with it as well as she manages the operation.
Great.
And finalize it whenever we need to.
I'm very pleased to see the work, you know, that you folks have been doing. And so on. I would like to, and I very much look forward to seeing the planning board and the zoning and conservation in particular up here. And I know that's taken a while, and I hope it doesn't take much longer.
No, the equipment here is all new. I think we've mentioned that on TV.
Less than a month old or something
right,
like that.
Right, literally. I mean, we're it was pretty much broken altogether. So the fact that that's happening now and the, there is and will be money in the budget, I think, for me to hire people, part-time staff is a line item in the budget. So I can actually send people here to record those things.
So you have all the tools now?
I do have all the tools now.
You should see starting Thursday, you know, all the stuff starting to take
place. Sure. If Trisha allows me to bill it, I will absolutely send someone here, yes.
Great. I share Mr. Murray's enthusiasm about the work that's been done in the past year. I think it's very noticeable. It's noticeable that you seem to be around a lot more places, and a lot more stuff's being done. This coming year, to me, is a crucial one. In that, you know, you're well on your way to proving that this is a standalone operation with its own committee and everything that you're seeking. I think that you're on your way.
Yes.
Whether it'll happen in June of this year or July of next year, that's maybe the question. I think if you continue to in the committee, along with you, continues the progress that's been made this year, I think that next year you could probably look forward to most of the things that you feel you need, so, in my opinion anyway. So.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, I also want to mention that both the PowerPoint and there's a PR44 video that you probably, have you all seen that video? Yeah, that's being played for them. So the public will see it, and it will also run again. Thank you. I feel like that we really have an opportunity to not only be an important resource for this town, but we could have a leadership position in the community and the surrounding communities, because it seems to me that there's a lot of communities that are in a similar contract situation with Comcast that are still kind of figuring out what's going on. And I feel like in some ways we have a head start on a couple of them, and maybe there's even a potential possibility how Scituate was using Norwell Studio. Who knows? Maybe we could lend a hand, and that would be more income for more cable things. So. It's really picking up speed, and it looks great in there. So I invite anyone to come down, email me, contact me. Be happy to tour.
So if we
hold on one second,
can just take a quick look at the actual budget.
Sure.
You've got two positions in here, some part-time money.
Yep.
The basic cost to equip a studio separate from high school. What is that?
That is. What we're hoping to do, and this is part of this rollout here, is that the high school in and of itself, and I think this lends itself to what Joe is saying, what we clearly at some point we want to have a site for cable television that's not in the school, that's actually, that there would be something for the town itself that wouldn't require everyone to come to the high school necessarily. Right now it's set up and it's working and it's great. But I think that clearly in light, I mean, I went to 15 different community television stations, and that's generally what happens in these cases.
What is this? What is that money?
That is the exact amount of money that it takes to install three cameras in a control area. So it could be set up anywhere.
So this is to equip a studio, not in the high school.
Right.
Off location.
One-time expense. It would be a one-time expense outside of it. But that we're talking about, this would be, because this is not even, this would be for the upcoming year of, you know, going from from 12 to 13, basically.
So, John, in our strategy or our plan of going forward with Gates, there's a possibility, since Gates is pretty spacious, if the board were to go forward with that plan and the town were to approve it, to put a studio that fits the needs and the requirements of your committee. And
sure.
Right?
Yes.
So
absolutely.
It might make sense to kind of hold on to that money for now instead of trying to spend the money
yes.
to potential sites, because if we're going to be doing that in the next
3 to 5 years, that might make sense to plan a studio of long-term.
Yeah, I agree with that reasoning. I think that's fair. I mean, I think that we're putting this in because, I think it falls in line with what makes sense and is comparatively fair and reasonable. I mean, for citizens who might not be able to fall within the high school hours of operation it would make sense to have some kind of satellite site, secondary site. But if that isn't in the cards for this fiscal year, that's understandable. I mean, I think
Joe's point was, you just got a new studio, just got all the equipment, let's see the demand, let's see the activity, let's see the output, and then you start talking about going to the next.
I agree with that reasoning. I think that's fair.
So what is the next line item? Is this hardware? I mean, is this actual equipment? Support studio equipment?
Right, and it really is.
The existing studio or the?
No, this would be for the proposed satellite site.
All right, so that's gone.
What, the equipment maintenance, is that for the equipment that you have now?
That's for the equipment we have now. I mean, there is all of the editing stations that we have software, and all those things are, hard drives go out, things happen, and that's actually proved itself to be true. I mean, we have a fair amount of equipment that needs.
It actually proved itself to be true? All of it's true, right?
But yes, of course. No, I mean, yes.
What's the next line item? The studio rental.
That would be for the satellite side. I mean, we would have to rent a space of some kind. I mean, if we can get a situation with gates going, then we wouldn't need that.
Rent.
Right.
You wouldn't have to rent.
Website design.
I think that's crucial. I think that every single community television station has some semblance of a website. I've talked to all of the directors of the surrounding areas and all that, and everybody needs some way to access online the television station. So there's that.
So a lot of these items, the bottom two are also for, an expansion of a new location. I think John hit the nail on the head when he said that's all part of the master plan that we're doing. We're not going to go create some space in a building that may not be here in 2 years. So,
I agree with that. I mean, I think we talked about it with the cable, or we talked about it with Tricia, and I think that was something that had been proposed. But if it isn't in the cards for this year, it's okay. Right.
Another procedural point, just so you mentioned it just in passing, but just so everybody's aware that this is coming from the fees, Comcast fees. This is not part of the general levy fund. So this is money that's not available for anything else,
right?
So people
it's,
are aware
it's earmarked specifically.
This can't go to roads. This can't go to hire a policeman. This can't go to hire another teacher. This is required from the Comcast fee structure. That's a very important point for people to understand.
Second question
I had for you was, this money rolls over, right? So if we don't spend it this year, it goes into it goes into an account. So there's no urgency other than we want to offer as good a product to our citizens as rapidly as possible. But
exactly,
if we delay some of this by a year, the money doesn't disappear.
Yes.
So we can marshal our resources that way.
Yes, absolutely. There is also a total info cost that there's a thing that people like that news update part series. There's like a cost that's there. It's been presented to you guys before. It's like $900 or something.
I want to emphasize again that I think the board certainly seen it this year more than in past years, and we are looking forward to a first-class operation, which it appears that you are also.
Yes.
It may not come quite as quickly to you as you'd like, but believe me, I think we're committed to it. The money's there, as Rick pointed out. It's really in your hands. I mean,
it means a lot to me. Thank you.
Come back here next year. It'll be a slam dunk.
I will.
If everything's going well, hopefully.
Yeah, I'm obviously very committed to the project. I mean, I started here, and I mentioned it briefly in passing. But you remember, I was sitting in the conservation office with a pad of paper trying to figure out what to possibly do. And we have a, we really have a nice studio now. So I've, I'm very committed to the project. I see it working. I see people. There's a new news show. It's the kids have a new show.
You've done a good job getting it to this point, and yeah. I think now you'll we'll start seeing the fruits of your labor.
Yes.
We'll start seeing
yes.
the content on it. Good. All right. Thank you guys for coming
Thank
in.
Thank you.
Monty. Thanks, John.
Monty. Thanks, John.
Tim Moore. Oh, well.
And we'll just before we get to the other agenda item, Liz, I forgot your son's name.
John.
John is here on behalf of trying to get his Eagle badge, and one of his tasks is to sit through a Board of Selectmen meeting, which he's doing really well. But to take a look at community involvement, civic, and so I just want to acknowledge John and.
Zach, can you get him on there?
Yeah, we got
get
him.
And so I want to say congratulations and thank you, you know, John, for coming and also for doing just that, you know, to work hard for your badge. So just want to bring that attention to
do
the
I board. Understand you get a medal for sitting through these?
Really?
You have your choice. You can either go to the police station and sit in a cell for 8 hours, or you can sit through one of these meetings.
Good luck with it, my friend.
Moving on to item number 9, which is a report from the Water Resource Committee and the DPW Water Division. Mr. Banger.
Thank you. Get us set up here for a second.
Over.
Get our
Al, how'd you get that to work so
Get the what? How to get it to work?
Yeah.
I was in here earlier and tested it out. I dry ran it. It's one of the essential things. Last summer we implemented new water restrictions on lawn irrigation systems, and one of the things that you asked at the time that this was implemented was to get a report on the efficiency of all this. And let me introduce the people that are with me here tonight.
Great idea.
Jim DeBarros, Water
Hi,
Superintendent.
Jim.
Sarah Grady, Mass Bay Programs, also currently on assignment with North South River Watershed Association. Al Banger and John.
John Clarkson, I'm a member of the Water Resources Committee.
Yeah. Several other members of the committee who are not here tonight participated in all of this work but are not able to be here with us. Okay, so this is what we're here to do is to report back to you at your request what was the result, the success or the failures, the positives and the negatives of the restrictions, limitations we placed on use of our potable water for lawn irrigation. So we're here as three bodies. The North South River Watershed Association has been a great consulting group to the Water Resource Committee and to the Water Department, but to be clear, this is really the Water Resource Committee and the Water Department's recommendation and report back to you. What we're going to do today is talk about the impact of limiting the use of drinking water for lawn irrigation, and we're going to talk about then also our water withdrawal permit renewal. The Department of Environmental Protection issues us a 5-year water permit. That permit is due to be is expiring in August, and they are already sending out what the potential for additional restrictions in terms of what will be required for conservation in our water withdrawal permit for the next 5 years. And to be clear, the DEP, the E is environmental. So that's more than just what we need the water for fire protection and drinking water. It's also for the environment. And so we'll talk about that, and Sarah will get into that more particularly with some study, the work that we're doing that we think is quite impressive and will be impressive to the DEP, game and fish people, and others. But let me go on now. First, we're going to talk about what was the impact of limiting the use of drinking water for irrigation. There was an impact on water quality, and water quality is a very definable thing. It's esoteric, but it's also technical. We were able to, as a result of this new program for limiting water use for irrigation, was we reduced the reliance upon our pond water. Why is that important? Well, because well water tastes better, it's more table ready, it's full of minerals. Pond water is full of other materials that have to be removed. and has a pondy, fishier flavor. In order to get the pond water suitable and make it perfectly healthy as it is, once we've processed it, it requires more chemical treatment, but we were able to reduce our chemical treatment this year because we used less of the water treatment plant's pond water. Importantly, this resulted in a 19% reduction in a couple of elements that are byproducts of treating pond water with a chemical treatment plant. Now, let me assure you that our plant always has operated well below any kind of safety threshold, but this year we were able to reduce by nearly 20% the production of the trihalomethanes and the haloacetic acids, which are the byproducts of using chlorine gas to treat pond water. The second area I want to talk about is the impact on customer service.
Before you go there, can I ask a layman's question? So you're saying we process the pond water, our system knows what's pond water and what's well water?
Absolutely, yes.
So
we have four or five wells that we draw directly out of the ground. At the wellhead, we put in liquid chlorine and treat that water. It's virtually table ready, and that goes into the pipes and is distributed throughout the system. Pond water is taken out of the old open bucket.
Separate pump, and that pump goes to the
and that's pumped directly into the water treatment plant. So all the water that comes out of the wells, none of that goes into the water treatment facility. That's good to go from the time it comes out of the ground. There's a lot of assaying and measurements that's done to ensure that's the case, but that water is older and fresher than the water in the pond and requires less treatment. Now then they all get mingled into the system and then they're distributed to you. In 2010, 60% of the water you drank in the summer was processed from the pond water. In 2011, 40% of the water that was sent to you was processed from the pond water. One of our objectives is to reduce the reliance upon the pond water for the purposes of its less well water is less expensive to treat and requires less chemicals and less work, and it tastes better.
Great.
So, okay. The impact on customer service is this. We ran the system at lower water pressures. Now, water pressure in our system is not maintained by how hard we run our pumps, but rather how high we fill the standpipes or the tank on Maple Street and over there on Man Lot. The higher we run those tanks, the higher the pressure is at the taps at home. Because in 2010 and previous summers, the use of irrigation systems during the night drained the tanks, and we struggled all night to keep the tanks full enough so that during the daytime we had adequate pressure for homeowners, and also we didn't drop below a threshold where it could interfere with our ability to fight fires. We had to run a higher reservoir of water, which means we had higher pressure throughout the entire system. What that meant was, because we were able to run at a lower pressure, we had far fewer water main breaks. In 2010, we had 123 water main breaks. In 2011, we had only 29 water main breaks. Additionally, we had far fewer brown water complaints in 2011. We had nearly one-fourth of the complaints that we had in the previous year. Again, it's a function of herky-jerking the system around, stirring up the pipes, the higher pressure puts more strain in everything. Certainly a water main break stirs up the system, as well as just an extensive use of water drawing because of, say, numerous sprinkler systems coming out at the same time. And another factor, which sounds counter to the higher pressure, is that we have a number of smaller neighborhoods. These are the neighborhoods with 5, 6, 7 homes on them, usually built out behind someone's house. Some are cottages that were converted into homes. Those usually have much smaller, undersized, and many times clogged water lines. And literally, we would get complaints in the summers before of the pressure was such on those little lines that they could not, you know, if you were running your washing machine, it would interfere with my house, with my ability to take a shower. Okay, the water pressure would drop that noticeably. But we were able to maintain that water pressure more evenly this year because we didn't have those wide swings from the high pressure at night to then the lower pressure that was a result of the water system being drained from for those other reasons. Another this reduced the risk on anything that could happen with a large fire, and importantly, we avoided a water ban on all residents, including homes with irrigation systems. And what's happened in the past is where we've had water bans, it affects everybody. So if you have an irrigation system, you go from having irrigated your house or your lawn merrily to then having to not irrigate it at all, and that's very hard on your lawn. And I'll have to tell you, in the year 2010, that's exactly what happened in my home. I have an irrigation system. I used it merrily in 2010. Midsummer, I had to stop using it and had a lot of brownout as a result. This last summer, I adhered to the one day a week program and didn't have nearly the impact, didn't have that impact. So we avoided the water ban, and three neighboring towns, Norwell, Hanover, and I don't know if it was Cohasset or Marshfield, I can't remember, all had outdoor water bans last summer. And then we did a survey. We surveyed with the water bills all of our residents, all of our customers. 82% of them came back and answered yes in the little simple check mark, if you remember, because I'm sure you answered yes or no. We asked the question, yes, continue to limit the use of the systems, or no, don't continue that. And 82% of the residents responded. Of 3,500 people responded, 82% of them said yes, we like this program. I have a lot of verbatims, which are kind of interesting to read, but I won't do that now because some of them get a little ugly. those are the ones that were more enjoyable to read. Now, the actual operation, which is Jim's baby over there, it obviously placed less demand on the water treatment and distribution system, which resulted in those breaks in the brown water. It reduced equipment wear and tear, power consumption, fewer chemicals, reduced operational overtime. We're seeing operational cost reductions this year of $70,000 to $75,000 in reduced operating cost.
From what year to what year? From 10 to 11?
Yeah. In terms of, because running the treatment plant is a high energy intensive operation. However, it also, because we sold less water, so we had lower water billings in the July-November period. If you look up here, in this year, we're in now, which is FY11, we sold in that period $1.2 million worth of water. In the year before that, we sold $1.4 million worth of water. So we sold $200,000 less water to customers between these two summers. And then in the year before, but if you look in the year before that, we sold only $1 million worth of water. Then we sold nearly $1.4 million. And then before that, $800,000. So the amount of water we sell goes up and down. So I would have to say that FY12, the year we just completed, this summer, July and through November, our revenue was more or less in line with what we might expect, although lower than the previous year, as were the costs versus the previous year.
Now, how could that be the case when your graph here shows that it went up our top 200 users?
That's the previous year.
Right, but that's the previous year, and it came down because they...
No, but this is old data. This is not 10 and then 11. This is the year before that.
Yeah, but anyways, this line would have come down, right?
It did.
Right. So you lost all that revenue.
Yep.
And that's all, it's a tiered system. So this drop costs a heck of a lot more than this drop.
All of that water is at the higher tier.
Right.
Everything, actually, you see the little blue line down there? That little blue line at the bottom? I don't know if it's blue in yours. The little black line? That's
the flat
the,
one.
The average customer is
right.
using?
Right.
That's basically the low-tier water. You get much above that, you're in the high-tier water no matter what. You're at the 265 per. Yeah, so this is all high-tier water.
Right. I'm surprised that only impacted the revenue by $200,000.
$200,000, yeah. In July through November. The billings are July and November, yeah. But those are the billing numbers.
But there's high-tier users throughout the rest of the year as well. This is only... No, so he's talking about the impact of this water restriction, and the water restriction is only summer, so it's only on the high-tier users
that's what this graph
during
is.
The summer.
This graph is only June through November.
But those plots up there are annual sales, annual revenues?
Those are in each month,
July to November.
The amount of water consumed. So, for instance, in that in July 10, it was 80,000 gallons.
Up there?
For that household.
He's looking.
No, up there.
Oh, up there, I'm sorry.
That is that
this
your
is,
annual
these are
total
these
year?
No, these are this is how much we build water in July through November.
Is it in arrears? Right. That's the billing period July through November, when the bill
went
out.
Remember, our billing is a little bit weird. It's not quite as straightforward as saying, okay, how much did you sell in July, August, and September? Okay, because you read one-third of the people at the end of July, one-third at the end of August.
That number is just very surprising. I figured our revenue number would be hit by a heck of a lot.
Oh, no. It cost us about $200,000. Revenue numbers are, they don't lie. You know, you could look at the, you can see that. It's these. This is from the books, the billings, okay?
Okay.
Then there was an impact on the environment. We had less reliance upon surface water. The environment is primarily concerned with surface water. Water under the surface, the ground, can affect how much water is on the surface, but other creatures that are involved in that we share the water with are primarily interested in the surface water. As a result of this, we maintained more normal stream flows, and we reduced our carbon footprint due to the lower energy consumption because we didn't consume as much electricity using the treatment plant. We didn't produce as we didn't use as many chemicals in the course of this operation this year versus the previous year, and aesthetically, we eliminated the unsightly look of the empty reservoir when you come down Route 3A, and we all know that if it's good for the fish, it's good for the fishermen. There were a lot more fishermen and women out on the Route 3A park area doing fishing this year all summer long. And I want to move on to legal requirements and the impact on the legal requirements of this. It enabled us to meet the DEP's mandated consumption target of 65 gallons of water per person per day. Now, that's the threshold they've established, that when you're above that, they will impose more severe restrictions. And with our new permit coming up, they've already sent signals of what those new restrictions will be. We were not able to achieve 65 gallons per person per day in the past. We now are achieving that. 65 gallons per day, just for perspective, is almost 100,000 gallons of water for every family of four per year. So that's quite a bit of water being used. And the new permit requirements will force water suppliers such as ourselves to implement much more harsh restrictions if we don't achieve the target. And we're currently in the midst of applying for this new permit. And the DEP will require lawn irrigation limitations.
Where are we? You said we beat the 65, or we had 65?
We are
63.
Yeah.
We went from 68 to 65 to 63.
So just to wrap up my little portion here, it improved water quality, flavor, and clarity, because we didn't have to filter out components that we would have to filter out of the pond. It reduced water main breaks, and it reduced brown water issues by the numbers. It reduced chemical, electric, and maintenance and overtime costs at the treatment plant. For instance, the treatment plant last year ran 1 month. It ran 24 hours a day for 31 days in a row, and that darn near breaks the treatment plant. And that's a heavy cost of maintenance, chemicals, and overtime to do that. It helped the environment with the stream flow and reduced energy. And it avoided a townwide water ban that would have affected all of us. So by limiting slightly the use of water for lawns, it enabled all of us to share that water, which is a diminishing or precious resource. And it was seen for that reason probably as reasonable by 82% of the residents who answered that yes, they thought it was a reasonable approach. And importantly, it enables us and will enable us to achieve state mandated limits. So as a result, the Water Department and the Water Resource Committee recommend no changes in the current lawn watering limitations. And what we'd like to do is I'd like to talk now about the environmental side of it, and another interesting study that is being done, being led primarily by Sarah and North-South River Watershed Association. So let me slide this over to her.
Let's wait 1 second so we don't get lost. Does anyone have any questions to this point?
One question I had, Al, was, I do. I thought we got a lot of rain last year, too.
Which impact, interesting. Okay, here, hang on. There's rain. I thought that question might come up. You notice the dark blue line.
Yep.
The dark blue line is the average of the entire chart back to 2004. All right? Last year, we had a little over 10 inches of rain in June, July, and August, which is the subject period we're talking about because we're talking about Labor Day to Memorial Day. The previous year, we had maybe around 7 inches of water. The previous year, we had 20 inches of water. You want to talk a lot of rain. The year before that, it was much like the year we just finished, around 11 inches of water. The year before that, we had only 4 inches of water. Preceding year, 20 inches of water. The year before that, more than this year. The year before that, about the same as this year. So I would contend that it was about an average year. And you could say, well, gee, what about in this 2007 era when we had only 4 inches of water? That would be really hard on lawns. Well, it would be very hard on lawns, on everybody's lawn, because we would have been on water. We were on watering restrictions right from the get-go. I think in that year we went on watering restrictions like in early July. So,
do you know about the years after that?
We were on watering restrictions in 10 and in 8. Were we in watering restrictions in 9? Seems like we were.
Yes, every year, a couple of years ago.
Yeah, 20 inches of rain?
Yeah, even with 20 inches of rain. It has to do, because we were triggering water restrictions based upon what the reservoir does.
That all depends on what type of the year, too. You know, it's early spring, you know, June and July come around, too.
Right, but that's just June, July, and August.
And rain also, like right now, as Jim likes to say, if we get an inch of rain, we get an inch of pond. In years where it's been raining a lot, because this is a dry year right now, no snow, okay. So right now, an inch of rain is an inch of pond level. In many years, an inch of rain is 10 inches of pond level. Because if the ground's wet, when the water falls, it runs to the pond. If the ground's dry, as it is now, it goes in the ground. So to go back to your question, Mr. Danahy, last year was wetter than the previous year, but not an unusually wet year.
Any questions? Ms. Burbine?
Ann Burbine, Pennycrest Row. Mr. Banger stated that, and you reiterated, that the water funds were down $200,000. How much was saved to offset that $200,000?
So $75,000 of expenses
was saved.
Went down, yeah.
Yeah.
So it was a net loss of
125? Yes. And you have to look at it this way. You say, yes, we could have sold more water for putting on lawns. But in the course of doing that, we would have had to take more pond water. And that pond water, which the share this year of pond water in the summer was 40%. The previous summer, it was 60%. So yes, we could take more pond water and sell it to our customers. But we would submit that staying with moving towards continuous use of well water is a good program because it provides clearer, fresher, more sparkling water to our people. So if we had sold more water this year, it would have come out of the pond.
Also on the dollar.
Could I add to that?
1 second.
I think on the dollar side, there are additional savings that you can't quantify because you talked about how many fewer water main break-ins and all that sort of stuff, and you can't put a, I mean, one could put a dollar value on that, but you didn't include that in your $75,000, did you?
Correct.
Okay, so.
That was my point.
Yes,
that was going to be my point, that the chemical costs and the overtime costs is a hard dollar figure you can look at. We do not have the figures on what the additional water main breaks would have cost, and that's not included in that $75,000 figure. So actually, the savings are much greater.
Michael Escher, the question I guess I had was, the
the water line breaks, were they old pipes or new pipes, or were the breaks occurring in the newly renovated water pipe system?
Well, we don't know. I mean, that would be...
They would know if they repaired them, but...
Old pipes.
Well, that's 120. You're suggesting maybe it would have broken anyways.
More or less, over time.
Well, no. 129 broke under higher pressure. 23 or whatever it is broke under lower pressure. All of those were old pipes.
All 153.
Yeah. And when a pipe breaks, you're not replacing it. You're fixing the break.
Right. Okay. Why don't you continue and then we'll...
Okay. Thank you.
Right. Thank you. So I am going to go briefly... This is Sarah Grady. I'm just going to go briefly into the larger project that this watering restriction was part of. So the First Herring Brook project began when the town was interested in restoring herring to the First Herring Brook. At the same time that the town was considering its lack of herring, the town was also reaching its water withdrawal permit limit and had applied to increase its authorized withdrawals from 1.73 million gallons per day to 1.85 million gallons per day, so the current permit that's in place now. Letters were sent to the DEP stating the town's interest in maintaining enough flow in the river to restore herring while also meeting the needs of the town. So the project is about the ecological and municipal water balance in the First Herring Brook watershed. Currently, the permit states that the town should continue its partnerships with organizations such as the North and South Rivers Watershed and investigate the feasibility of restoring the First Herring Brook and potentially bringing herring back into the system. So the current sources are being used at or near the permitted withdrawal amounts up until recently. Less water tends to be available during the months when the water is needed for fish migration. Herring migrate into our ponds through coastal streams in the spring. And we actually do have quite a bit of water in the spring. That's when there's a lot of water available. The issue we have is in the late summer and early fall when juvenile herring are trying to exit the ponds where their parents laid eggs earlier a few months ago. And after a summer of using a lot of water, not only by the town, but also trees using water and evapotranspiration, there's not as much water for the fish to out-migrate from the system. And as Al mentioned, the town was just over its per capita use of 65 gallons per person per day, the state guidelines, which are averaged over the year. And this, it just kind of shows a profile of how water is used in the town. So this is shown with businesses included and without businesses included. The top 5% of water customers in town use about 20% of the town's water. The top quarter of the town uses about half of the town's water. The top 5% are using about the same amount of water as the bottom 50% of the community. And those high water users are using proportionally more water on average during the summer period, June, July, and August. Those average and median households increase their summer water use almost by nothing. That top quarter increases about 2%, the top 10% increase by 7%, and that top 5% increase their summer water use by 25%. So not only are those high-tier water users using more water all year round, they're using even more water during the summer.
Now, is that different from what our surrounding communities are doing? Cohasset, Norwell, Marshfield, Duxbury?
I don't know. I don't have their
I would imagine
their
it's
data.
Probably.
That is probably, I mean, that tends to be the pattern where a select few use more water than the majority. I know it's true in Concord. There was a similar analysis done, and it was similar proportions, I believe. So in order to try to tackle this issue, as you're aware, there was a lawn irrigation restriction in place. Just to remind you, it was irrigation systems only. You're allowed to water one day a week based on your voting precinct from Memorial Day to Labor Day. And it was based on a pilot effort in Franklin, Massachusetts, which used trash days, as Situate doesn't have trash pickup. Voting days were used instead, and a brochure was sent to all of the water customers. And this is sort of what was received, kind of bits and pieces. Explained the precinct that the recipient lived in and which day they were allowed to water on. So here are some results from summer 2011. In summer 2011, 170 million gallons were used during the summer. And we wanted to be able to compare the water use to previous years. So I got pumping data from the water department from 2007 through 2011. And kind of wanted to see what would be the range of savings. So if you look back at 2009, which is the recent minimum water use during that time period, the town used 197 million gallons, or 27 million gallons more. The average of those years, the town used 219 million gallons, or about 49 million gallons more. And then in 2007, which if you recall is that very dry year, the town used 245 million gallons, or 75 million gallons more than was used in summer 2011. In addition, the average daily pumping was 1.84 million gallons per day, compared to, again, those same time frames, between 0.28 and 0.82 million gallons per day, depending on what year you compare it to. If you compare it to the average, summer 2011 saved about 0.53 million gallons per day. And it's important to point out that that savings is actually based on two different components. The first is that there were many improvements to the water distribution system. There were leaks found, and those saved about 0.22 million gallons per day. The rest of that is made up by the watering restriction. So, and that's actually on this graph here. So again, 0.22 million gallons per day is the baseline improvement, and on top of that, 0.31 million gallons per day could be attributed to the restriction. So this graph shows the pumping data averaged for each month for 2007 with one little blip for 2012, so 2007 through 2011 mostly. And you can see that the pumping does vary from year to year. That dotted line is the average of the years prior to the restriction, 2007 to 2010. And the blue line is 2011. So you can see that it is lower than all of the previous years, with the exception of July of 2009, which was when all of that rain in 2009 occurred. Didn't have to pump as much. So that baseline improvement, it would essentially be in the winter difference between the dotted line and the blue line, and then the summer would be the improvements above and beyond that. And just
go back to that one for 1 second.
Yeah, sure, no problem.
The yellow line is last year, right?
The orange line is 2010. The blue line is 2011.
If you go at the peaks, the one that's at about 2.4.
It's about 2.5. Yep.
And then you've got 2.1. About was 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And you're saying 0.22 of that was just repair work.
It's about about 0.2, yeah.
So the difference between the 2 years was only 0.1 something.
Right, but 2010 was the closest, it was the lowest year other than the 2007 and 2008, and climatically, we were actually closer to 2008 this past summer. So that would be...
Which one's that?
That's the green line. At least as far as precipitation, rain is concerned.
Okay.
Yep. So, and this just reinforces the point that Al was making about the proportions of water from surface water versus wells, compares 2010, which is the lighter colors, to 2011, which is the darker colors. Blue represents the wells, and the brown represents the surface water. So overall, less water used in 2011, particularly during the summer, and more of the water that was used was from the wells.
And that's in part coming because we're Jim has had an aggressive program of rebuilding the wells, so because we've had the aha, and it's now our goal, or my personal goal as well, to serve well water to our people and to not have water bans. And so redeveloping wells, we've got another well we can bring online that has had some trouble in the past with manganese, and we're going to be asking for a capital investment to be able to strip the manganese out. We've seen a package plant in Duxbury that does what we want to accomplish on well number 17. And our goal is to reduce the reliance upon surface water, Old Oak and Bucket Pond, and the reservoir to those extreme circumstances when we need more water for human consumption and firefighting. One of the questions you'll have is, gee, during dry summers, we're going to need to get more water. Well, in fact, in dry summers, we can't use more water from the environment because the environment already needs that water. In dry summers, the impact is going to be the same on us as it is on the rest of the environment. And this is not like a personal mantra. If you know me, I'm not the greenest bulb in the pack, but it's pretty clear that the legal requirements are going to be imposed upon us that will restrict our use of drying out the surface water. The national movement to water conservation, to shared water usage, is moving from the west to the east. Water has always been a precious resource in the west. It's becoming more and more so in the east. And it's a shared resource. Everyone has the right to use it, just as they have the right to use the air. So we have to share this resource among all of our residents, as well as other species. Another question I had asked North South River Watershed Association, Samantha Wood, as well as Sarah Grady, was, well, why do we care about the herring? I mean, let me just ask that question, the red herring question. And the answer impressed me, and that was that the herring is an indicator of the health of our ecosystem. And if the herring aren't, it's just a good indicator of how strong is our system. The herring then feeds the ocean, feeds the bigger fish feed then the bigger fish, and there's more fish, the stronger ocean environment, and a stronger aquatic environment inland. And what else?
Oh, well, they're a primary food source for striped bass and bluefish. They help balance the transfer of food or nutrients between the ocean and our ponds, and they essentially provide a connection between the ocean environment and our coastal rivers and streams.
Mr. Murray.
Just to chime in one point on that, because you probably know where I am on this issue, but again, DEP mentions herring, and we are required under the current water withdrawal permit to make sure that we're doing everything possible to enable the herring to do their herring thing. So it comes from DEP, and they're doing that for part of the reasons that Sarah and Al mentioned, but also as a very local indicator species, because they're a good indicator of whether you've got enough water in your local system as well. So that's why herring are being picked on or being mentioned quite a lot. It's because they've got the large-scale macroeconomic issue. There's a lot of people that are thinking some of the decreases in groundfish has to do a lot with herring, but that's a whole separate issue. But there's that large-scale issue that DEP is bringing up herring for, but also the local issues that are mentioned in our water withdrawal permit. So, regardless of your feeling about herring, they're in the DEP permit.
It's designed just to augment the wells, you know, it was the main purpose to just run that surface water treatment plant like it is being run.
It's not supposed to run 31 days in a row, 24 hours a day. Good overtime.
Yeah, but I'm dying to.
John, do you have any? Joe?
No, I think.
All right, thank you. You know what, why don't we open it up to the floor, and then I just have a couple of quick questions, we'll go from there. Are there any comments from the floor?
I have some.
I'm gonna let him go first, because he was here.
I should have kept my mouth shut and spoken at 7.
It wouldn't have had the impact it's gonna have now.
I don't know how much impact I'll have now, but I would like to say.
Actually, you can just sit down, you don't have to stand up and say.
Zach, can you? Zach, can you get him?
I don't mind standing, I've been sitting too long. Look, a lot of work has gone into this report, and I appreciate it, and I appreciate Al and the rest of the committee. So I'm not going to dispute any of the findings, except I will say, the survey was a charade with 20% of the town having water irrigation systems. Of course, we knew in advance what the findings would be. It was a needless expense, just throwing. I'm going to be short, because there's a lot of redundancy in this presentation, and I'm not here as a diplomat. You're not going to remember these up, down, year 10, 11, 12, 9, 7, 6, and so on. What is important is minimal utilization of the water, complying with the state, complying with the town, and I respectfully suggest that if we're only going to be able to irrigate our water one day a week, we were lucky last year, August, there was a fair amount of rain. If we run into a dry spell, we'll have a sand lot, as I indicated a year ago. And my suggestion is, since we're advocating the same system as a year ago, why does it have to be in a 24-hour segment? Why not 12 hours Monday night, 12 hours Thursday night, or 12 hours Tuesday night, 12 hours Friday night? In addition, we'll gain water because during the heat of the day, there's considerable condensation. So that water is wasted. If you do it at night, the only thing that is negative about it is you're not going to be able to probably monitor abusers as well as you can during the day. But that's it. I'm not disputing any of these findings, but I would, with all due respect, request 2 12-hour segments rather than 24 hours in one day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Name?
That was Martin Gancher from Crescent.
Okay, just
Crescent Street?
Crescent Ave.
Crescent Ave, is that your address?
58 Crescent. John knows where I
know,
I live.
Very well.
John knows where I live, and so does Rick.
Beautiful home.
Yes, sir.
I was thinking the same thing he was saying. I'm Tom McCusker from 50 Gannon Parish Lane. If to do it twice a week instead of the one, I mean, watering one day a week really does nothing. I mean, how would that affect if they did the twice a week rather than the one day a week? I mean, would you be at 50% instead of down 40 or from 60 or?
Okay.
But by the way, one other point. You know, just as we hear about the apathetic voter, so we have, I've spoken to a good percentage of the people in town who have irrigation systems, and they complain bitterly about it. But where are they tonight? Not one person showed up. They're all too busy. And I'll guarantee you this, I have more valid reasons not to be here than any of them who are absent tonight.
Thank you.
Michael Escher, I am one of those sprinkler people that I am here. And
just do it, yeah.
I think you stated earlier about the reports, and you know, I think they did a great job, but I think there's more to it than just this mandatory one-day watering. I had met with one of the selectmen earlier this year to say that there's a better solution than just arbitrarily picking a date of June 1st to August 31st of putting a water restriction. Most of your drought period is really between a 4 and 6 week period. So week of 4th of July until about mid to third week in August. That is really the high demand for drought in the state, and that is a proven time period. The fact that you're going from June 1st arbitrarily of putting this restriction on really affects not only people that do irrigate and want to maintain the values of the properties, but also the people that have gardens and grow vegetables, and maybe there was a set aside that they could water that differently. But if we're in the mindset of water conservation, then those people should be all part of the sprinkler ban as well. I hate to say that, but it's got to be treated the same. Just because someone has a garden, a large garden, versus someone that has nice landscaping, shouldn't be singled out. The other thing too is the one-day watering. If precinct 1 and precinct 2 have, you know, can only water on Monday, but if Monday's raining or thunder showers, people still feel that they have to water because that's their only day. And that's, to me, the worst type of conservation you can do. You're wasting more water during rainy days, but people feel that if they're only going to be allowed to water one day, then that's what they're going to do. I've heard some people saying that if I can only water one day, I'm going to water for a 12-hour period. Again, that's crazy. That's the mindset of people thinking that they're getting something taken away and they want more, you know, to get that share back. I think a smart solution is through proper water conservation, through smart controllers for irrigation, which have been started on the West Coast and then working the way east. These smart controllers measure air temperature. They also have a quicker shutoff response. How many times have you seen a sprinkler system going off when it's raining or drizzling? That's because the old technology hasn't really caught up with what's been going on in the past, you know, 5-10 years. The other thing too, it automatically shuts off during heavy rainstorms. So there are some devices that can be added onto certain irrigation controllers for minimum cost and to do water conservation. And the flip side of it is people are going to want to keep their properties looking nice and green. It keeps the value of the houses in situ up, which probably has a secondary effect on that and all. But people may go to the alternative, and that's sinking in wells. Sinking in private wells, not yet, has been banned by the state, but you know, the Irrigation Association of New England is on Beacon Hill keeping an eye on these type of decisions that's going on right now, where eventually wells are gonna be banned. So I think we need to really think about how we're moving forward, especially on a summer of last year, where I think the savings was a negative 125. It, you know, really wasn't the savings, but I think we just really need to look at it a little more carefully than just blanketing the time. And you still have the voluntary water restrictions available by the water department. I think people, when they hear that, they do realize what's going on. People that drive by the reservoir, they use that as a barometer. When the reservoir is down, they kind of like, ooh. They think psychologically, am I going to have enough water to turn on in my kitchen? So I think there's some other things out there that we can explore than just, you know, repeat last year's decision.
Okay. Great. Yes, sir.
I would just like to add to that too. Ryan Lovangi, I do have an irrigation system as well. I'd love to be able to see us to be able to use it more than one day. To Jay's point there, some days it rains on the day that you have it, you don't use it, and another week goes by, your lawn starts to dry up. I have it on a timer, it's controlled, it's efficient, it hits just my yard. Correct me if I'm wrong, but people were able to run regular sprinklers anytime they wanted to. and you're relying on individuals to turn on the sprinkler, they go in their house, forget about it for hours, and then go back out and turn it off. So I would say that I'm probably even more efficient by using my irrigation system strategically and hitting just my grass. I've seen people hitting the street, the pavement. It's impossible to get that to hit every part of your lawn. And,
it's a good point.
Very strongly
about
that.
Last year I was against this. I'm still against it. I think it's a little bit too strict, but there's a lot of very valid points that they bring up. It's not an easy decision one way or the other. You know, what happens is the people with the automatic systems, they just go on. And Al showed us what the drain is on the tanks, that it just goes from full to empty at 4 o'clock in the morning. That's because you've put it on and you forget about it. I would like to pose a question. I mean, people are coming up, I'm not an expert at this, and I don't know that anyone else here is, but if we thought that this plan was too harsh, what would your alternative be? If we thought that one day a week was just not enough, was too strict of a plan for us, what would your next?
I guess I'd have to ask what we mean by the term too harsh.
I mean, clearly there's a lot of
benefits. Let me tell you, an ugly little truth that I didn't bring up about this is in the verbatims that came back on the cards. If there's one comment that runs throughout them, it's police it more. Neighbors didn't obey the rules. I see them running all night long. I see them running in the rain. You know, so we can achieve further restrictions, a further conservation of our water if people would in fact do what the current restriction is. Then we might be able to consider additional programs. But right now we're in a position where we've accomplished the objective. We are doing policing. So again, we are issuing fines.
How many fines did we issue about?
Half a dozen.
Over the whole summer?
Yeah.
I was at some residents multiple times.
It's not on gardens. The state, I'll have to tell you what we're heading off. A monster we're trying to head off is the state wants to implement all outside water use restrictions as of May 1st. The towns will have to implement a non-essential use of water as of May 1st. And we're saying to the state.
In lawn or sprinkler, everything.
Car washing, dog washing, non-essential. You can water your vegetable garden, okay?
The state wants to do that to every community?
That is part of their current restriction. The state is saying we are fed up with the idea that people can police themselves, put in more technical devices. I'm totally familiar with the irrigation system devices. I have a 32-zone system at my property. And it has all the bells and whistles and fancy features on it, okay? And I pay to get it blown out, and I pay to get it fixed in the spring. So very familiar with it. So this, we're not dealing here with an unknown situation. We have on our committee John Clarkson, who was in the lawn
back
business.
To my question, what would the alternative be if you had to ratchet it back one level? We were at carte blanche before last year. Do whatever you want, whenever you want, when it's raining, whatever.
Yeah.
And now we went to probably the other extreme. You couldn't let people water not more than once a week. So where is...
We went from odd to even days, and then the restrictions got even...
Yeah, the previous year, we ended up ramping up in the past restrictions
well,
to odd even days.
I think, to someone's point back there, in August, usually we hit some sort of dry
in August, we've dried out the reservoir, and so we implement restrictions.
Odd even
right, odd even
But if we
days.
Did something from the get-go in June... Would it be odd even days? Would that get us where we had to be? Or?
No. I wouldn't recommend any change. We looked at a whole series of changes. We looked at going to 2 days per week, partial days. Now we're dealing with twice as many systems being run at different times, trying to police all of that.
Well, the policing, we gave out 6 tickets, so it's not like we're
policing.
Tough.
It's very tough. I mean, we have town employees out responding to neighbors' calls saying my neighbor is running his water system. This is what we're doing. And judging by the number of comments, there's a lot more water systems being run at night than we're following up on. So if people would, anyway, I guess I'm going to have to
defer
to answering the question, what would we do differently? You can come up with a plan that's different than one day per week. It could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 7 days per week. One day is one day. That's where the current restriction is, and it's working. Lawn care industry says one day per week is deep watering one day per week is better for a lawn. It creates a healthier root growth. Let me turn to John Clarkson, who has been in that industry.
John has a question.
I just have a question. I met with Mike Lesher last year, actually, and Mike would approach me after we had made that decision. I voted to implement this to see how it would go for a full year. And Mike had mentioned about the smart controllers. I noticed in the documentation for tonight, you'd mentioned, or somebody had mentioned, or indicated the requirements for electronic monitoring devices. I'm assuming they're one and the same, smart controllers and electronic monitoring devices.
Who said that?
I noticed that you have electronic. Mike was telling me, and Mike's behind. I know, Mike, you can talk further on it, but about a device that can actually identify the saturation of the lawn.
And we could mandate that those are installed in every system in town, and we could police that those were installed, and we could check up on it.
That's where I'm going here. So my point being is, if we're going to try to conserve going forward, can we mandate that such a device is actually installed, certainly on the new systems going forward, somehow of trying to do it with the ones that are in existence so that those people are going to be obligated to do it and see how that goes going forward. Because if they work, then I think it's a win-win all the way around. The systems don't go on. You're conserving energy or conserving water.
Yeah, they would. They would go on in dry weather when there's not much rain. They would, in fact, go on more frequently at the time when there is less rain,
True.
Which means less water in the reservoir, which means the reservoir drops again, and we're drawing more water out of the reservoir. See what I'm saying? It's the less rain is for all. When there's less rain on my lawn, there's also less rain.
No, I understand that. My thought was to see what the data would come up with this year, and I think it's given us a baseline of saying, okay, one day a week, this is where we're at. Is there a happy median? I know that you're looking for a full ban on it, or not full ban, full ban, mm-hmm. No. You want the same restrictions that we implemented last year, one day a week.
That would avoid a full ban, as has been implemented.
John, I understand that. My point being is that last year we did that, and we didn't have to do a full ban. So my question is there a happy median between scaling back, as the chairman had said last year, a draconian way to something that's going to be a little bit more less draconian, a little bit more beneficial to the home user, obviously, but not necessarily forcing the town to implement a full ban. That impacts the rest of the town. So that's where I'm coming from right now. I guess you're telling us no. It should be one day a week, water for 24 hours on that day, and that's it. That's what I'm hearing.
Well, that's our recommendation, yeah.
Okay.
I honestly don't think this is a hugely draconian thing. We're talking about in-lawn water systems, okay? And we're talking about the industry standard and the recommendations from the professional associations is that one day a week is what they recommend anyways, okay? And I've read that, and I've been at a bunch of these meetings where they've had people from industry come in and point that out and mention that. And we're talking about watering our lawns here. We're talking about making a lot of savings to the system and the overhead and complying with state mandate and all this sort of thing. I really don't see this as a draconian. I know you used that word last year, so I'm specifically using it, and I think we're going to agree to disagree on this one, Mr. Vignani. I don't see this as a huge draconian impact at all. You can still, if you wish,
if you're going to use it. I didn't say draconian impact. I said a draconian measure. We took it from this extreme.
I don't think it's
that extreme.
I don't think it's
obviously
a draconian measure.
People aren't going to die if they don't get to water their
Correct.
Lawn.
If you want, in addition to your one day a week, if you're one of those that have an in-lawn system, and interestingly, there's a, I do think we need to stay away. I bet most people that do have in-lawn systems have larger yards, but that's not the case, because always the case. I know many people that have very small yards that have an in-lawn system as well. It's just more convenient and easier to do because you don't have to get out yourself. But if the one day a week isn't working for those with an in-lawn system, you're free to put out a sprinkler on the other days of the week if you wish. So it's not like we're forbidding it, and we're not addressing at all gardens or anything like that. So moisture sensors, you know, this was discussed as well. Personally, if we wanted to mandate every in-lawn system to have a moisture sensor at their cost, right? That's not a small cost. That's a couple hundred dollars at least. And then you have to make sure that's going and working, and we have to monitor that as well. That's going to be a big cost for individual people. And for us to mandate, okay, everybody put in a couple hundred dollars worth of a moisture sensor in there, I'm not sure I want to go in that direction. And my last comment was, several people said there's only 6 tickets written or something. I would hazard, I don't know, and what's that rule, never ask a question you don't know the answer to? But I would bet that there are many more conversations that you had with people than just those 6 households that you ticketed. I would bet you probably had dozens of conversations with people, and it was only those people that were, you know, still refused to comply. I would hazard most people that you talked to said, okay, thanks, you know, you got me, or I was unaware, and we'll move it forward. So the number 6 being in terms of tickets doesn't mean that There's only 6 people that you had conversations with.
Well, Rick, what's your objection?
Excuse me. Wait to be addressed. Hold on for a second, okay?
Just as I'm listening here, I, you know, how fortunate we are in Scituate. How very fortunate to be sitting here tonight talking about the disaster of automatic lawn sprinklers. We could be talking about roofs being blown off houses because of a tornado. We could be talking about people who weren't able to put food on their tables to feed their family. I mean, this is not the biggest problem facing the world today, believe me. I hesitate to say it, but I think if someone was watching from outside of this, they'd have a smile on their face, because it's not that big a deal. If we would have a problem getting our water withdrawal permit, if this would make it easier to get our water, that's the bottom line for me. All right, I know a couple of years ago there was a lot of discussion about not getting the water withdrawal permit or having us being forced to do a lot more things in order to get that permit. If this speeds that process or makes that process easier for us, I think it's a small price to pay. I mean, I know, and we all know, that anybody can water anytime they want in this town. There are people who water 7 days a week with automatic sprinklers. It's impossible to police it. If you want to water, water. I mean, what else can we do? You know, no one's going to drive around. The police department's not going to drive around and knock on your door at 4 o'clock in the morning. If you feel that your lawn is that important, water. Go ahead and do it. That's the way I look at it. But for the people who want to abide by the rules, then they'll follow the rules. So that's all I have to say on it. Thank you.
Right. And I don't think we're making this a huge issue. I think that we're just doing our job as thorough selectmen to discuss any issue to the degree that it needs to be discussed.
I certainly think so, we've discussed this to that need.
Well, we're almost there. all right, so we'll go around one more time. Yes, sir.
If we were going to do it, then why wouldn't we include the people that use the regular sprinklers out there, too? Why aren't they in the same boat?
Well, we found the data shows that the irrigation systems are the ones that are the biggest drain on the system.
Well, I put my irrigation system in. They said I would use actually less water using the irrigation system than I would by putting sprinklers on all the time.
That's because you never have to think about it. You just turn it on and it goes 7 days a week. To actually have to get...
No, you need signage.
Excuse me.
I can set it anytime I want.
No, no, I'm saying it just happens. If you have to actually get out of your house with your hose, it's not as big of a drain on the system, and it's not all at the same time. I mean, Al, again, I'm not necessarily in favor of this, but Al showed us data that said at 5 o'clock in the morning, the water system just plummets because everybody's water system is sucked.
It's hard to use the sprinkler system, the other type, and there are not many of them, so the impact is really small. To limit them would be just fine as well.
But it's
relatively
such a
few. If it would seem fairer, I think that's a reasonable thing to go do. You know, everybody knows what precinct they're in.
I know you had your hand up.
Yeah, Mike Gilligan. I'm a contractor in Scituate. I have a lot of customers that have irrigation systems. And what I found is I'm abided by all the rules that have been put in place. And then the days that you can water, you know, you get that 24-hour period, my customers will say, you know what, why don't we just water all day? Well, no, that doesn't make sense. My feeling is, you know, can you find a happy medium somewhere? And all the comments that were made this evening were pretty much spot on. The board, they've done a wonderful job putting everything together. Mike has made some valid points. Martin has made valid points. Mr. Levanchy's made valid points. And it just comes down to, you know, a couple days a week, if you set up the irrigation system properly and the time on it, you set up the zones, if you say, okay, on certain days, this house only has a half an hour it can run its irrigation system, or 10 minutes per zone. And the way that they're set up is they're going to hit the lawn areas, and they're not going to waste the water on the street. When you have people running the irrigation systems for 24 hours a day, I mean, I work all around town. I see it, water all over the street, running down the street in some places because they're so afraid that they're going to lose their lawn. But Mr. Norton honestly made the best point here. It's what it comes down to. The town needs to get the permitting for the water. And what do you end up doing? Where's the happy medium in all of this? And how does everybody work together so it doesn't become a big issue? Because there is a trickle-down effect in all this. There's a lot of people that rely on the lawn service to pay their bills, you know, pay their help. You know, there is a trickle-down. What if people go and install wells? Does the town lose water revenue? If everybody's tapping into wells, do they lose their water? You know, and if you want to make a big hypothetical over the whole thing. You know?
Okay. Well, I think Joe's other good point is that we've talked this a lot. John, and then...
I'd be open to is trying to do it twice a week. I was just mapping it out and saying, if you're to do the precincts and then do it every fourth day, so that way you'd go, you know, because there's seven precincts, right, if I'm not mistaken?
Six.
So, you know, you just do it, knock that out then. You know, you could just say, okay, if you're precinct one, do it Sunday, do it Wednesday. So at least you have 4 days that you're able to turn the water on, keep the lawn going. And instead of going to one day a week, try 2 days a week to see what the data would come for 1 year. If it turns out that there's a water ban, then I'd be very convinced to say then 1 day a week going forward is the way we have to do it. My only reason for saying it is because if it doesn't impact, Joe's right, if it comes down to water withdrawal, that's the most important issue that we have to face. Otherwise, all this is moot. But I would be inclined to say if we could try to do it twice a week, see how that shoots out for this year. And if it's detrimental, then yeah, I'd agree next year to say 1 day a week. Now we know. But that's where I'm at. I think we should do the implementation of smart control. I think that's something going forward makes sense.
I agree with John. I think we all agree with Joe that there's many more important issues than people watering their lawn, but if there's any way we can tweak a little bit more to the right,
it has me.
And give it a shot. Rick, this will be the last one.
I would just, rather than try something else for this year, I'd be more comfortable keeping with this current system for another year, so at least we have 2 years of data with different amount of rainfall and all that sort of thing, and then reevaluate at the end of that. It's basically the same thing, but different side of the coin. I'd be more comfortable keeping it as it is for one more year so then we can see different variables.
I have to admit, that's where the committee came out. We talked about alternatives, and I hesitated to answer your question, Mr. Chairman, because I can't speak for the whole committee, okay? But we looked at several alternatives, including 2 days a week, banning midday. You know, the state's going to may require May 1st through sometime in September, November, or something like that. And we said, look, we have a current permit. we should stay this course for this year, and then we'll need to reevaluate because the state may impose additional or different restrictions on us, which will cause us to have to tune the system further next year. Our current permit runs through August. If they issue a new permit in August, we'll have to change, most likely, how we're managing outdoor water use anyway. So where we came out was, let's study this system the way it is, keep it this way, and recommend no changes to what is in existence, and then reevaluate at the end of this next season.
The question there would be, would the state mandate that you keep it the way you have it?
And no, they won't. They're already in the, they're indicating additional further restrictions.
Right. So this may one of our, be our few opportunities to notch it back.
Yeah.
All right, well, we've beat this one up. Are we making a motion? What are we,
No.
What are we doing? That's just discussion? Okay. So, thank you for coming and discussing, and we'll... One quick question now. What was the question that was on the card? What was the actual question?
Sir, you bypassed me.
It said, last summer we implemented a water conservation policy that limited the use of in-ground lawn irrigation systems to one day per week from Memorial Day to Labor Day. The purpose of this was to conserve water and eliminate the need for a ban on outdoor water uses. We would like your feedback. Would you like to see this limitation on in-ground irrigation systems be re-implemented next summer? Please tell us your preference by checking below and mailing this card back.
So did it say one day?
It said yes. Yes, it does say one day. Yeah.
I'll let you have the final word, sir.
Thank you. First of all, Joe, you made a philosophical statement.
Absolutely.
You bet there's more important issues. But if that be the case and we follow through on what you're saying, there's no need for selectmen. There's no need for anything.
A lot of people would agree with you.
I know. I might make a referendum on that.
I might vote for it.
And the reason you say is you've got all rocks and pebbles on your ground, so you don't give a damn about that.
I'm sure my son-in-law would not agree with you with that.
But yeah, you and Kurt got together. Boy, you're pretty smart. This gentleman made a very valid point about we want to upkeep the appearance of our house, our grounds. And if someone were in a position, I hope I never have to sell my house. I hope the Lord takes me first. But I'll be back next year. But certainly, you want to keep up the appearance of your home. And if the grounds aren't looking right, that spoils everything. And Rick, I don't know what your objection is to making it 2 days a week, but the same 24-hour consumption of water.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming in. Thank you all for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll move on to item number 10, other business.
I'll start.
Go ahead.
I just want to say, don't forget this weekend at.
Mike.
Hang on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. This weekend, don't forget, 1 o'clock Sunday, the St. Patrick's Day Parade. So for those people, you know, come on down. If you try to avoid parking, they will be ticketed. Cars will be towed if they're in areas that they shouldn't be. But come on down like any time. It's a great family event. Second thing I wanted to say is that I want to congratulate the girls basketball team yet again. Phenomenal season. I know Sean Harris would love to be here to talk about it. The reason why he's not here is because his daughter played. And they were at the Garden today, and we should have him in to congratulate him. It's a great feat to go to the Garden to perform, and I really commend them. They were undefeated until tonight, and they played a really great game to go to overtime only to lose. Coming up at the end of April, I think it's 28th, Shipshape Day. People might be thinking about that, given the fact that the weather's been so good. I meant to ask Al, but I believe it is the 28th. It's a Saturday. We'll hear more information about that. The last thing is, 2 weeks ago, I ended up going to an event put on the Interfaith Choral Festival, and Zach was actually a participant with a great voice, And it was actually almost a month ago. I had this here and I forgot it, but I wanted to at least acknowledge it. It was a phenomenal event. The various churches and their chorus or the choirs sang, and phenomenal. The talent in this town is unbelievable. This was a free event, and if they'll do it again next year, I'll certainly tell people about it. Just go. You know, it has nothing to do with your denomination. It's just phenomenal talent. Great time by the choirs that participated. Outside of that, that's it.
Rick?
Yeah, we don't have correspondence on the agenda today, Mr. Chair, but we did get a letter regarding the fires that have happened, that hit our town, hit Humor Rock, last week since then. I just would like to read this letter. It was just in our file today. I think it really exemplifies one of the aspects that makes this town great. It's addressed to Chief Judge, Fire Chief Richard Judge. It says, "Dear Chief Judge, my family and I live in the house that survived the Humor Rock inferno last Thursday. I want to say thank you to you and all the firefighters who came and battled an impossible situation. It was a perfect storm, 100-year-old houses close together and 50-mile-an-hour winds. As I was in full-blown panic, everyone was attacking the fire without hesitation. It was quite impressive. The response time from all the different towns was astonishing. One minute I was standing there by myself, I turn around and there's a legion of men from five different towns. If not for your quick and decisive actions, I have no doubt that my house would have been next. I hope everyone in Scituate appreciates the professionalism and bravery of their fire department. Please extend our appreciation to all the supporting towns. On behalf of myself and my family, I'd like to extend our most heartfelt gratitude for a job well done. Respectfully, Arthur Brown and family on Marshfield Avenue in Humor Rock." And this was also sent to the Patriot Ledger. And I just think that's that encapsulates it very nicely in a succinct letter. And thank you to all our firefighters and for the people in the area who helped out, as well as to the various charity organizations in town, SANS, and others that are helping deal with those people, that help those people that have been displaced. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Joe?
Yes, I also went through an event this week that I think probably a lot of important things go on in town, but I don't think there's anything more important than the forum that was put on by the, I believe it was the Health and Wellness Department at the high school. It was an afternoon, it was a morning panel and an evening panel dealing with opiates. Now, I know there are more fun topics to talk about. I know there are more exciting topics to talk about, but there shouldn't be, because this is probably the most important issue facing the youth of this town, is the misuse of opiates. Chief Stewart was there. Mike Stewart, who heads our drug enforcement area, was there. Counselors from the school, health workers from the hospitals, most important, people who are in recovery, young people who walk our streets who are in recovery from the use of opiates. It is a, and this word is overused, I know it's overused, it is an epidemic. And if you don't understand that, you better get it, people, because it's an epidemic in this town. And unfortunately, it's not just bad kids who get into this. It's all kids. It's good kids, it's your kids, my grandchildren are all capable of falling into this pit. And once you fall into this pit, it's a deep, deep hole, because it's not only you who are affected, but it's your family and your sometimes it results in deaths. All the house breaks we see and all the car breaks we all talk about that go on, and not only this town, I hope everyone understands I'm not talking about just Scituate, but all the breaks and the crime, and I'm not going to ask the chief to comment on it, but I know what his comment would be, are directly related to the use of opiates and the money needed to keep people in that scene. So again, I congratulate the Health and Wealth. I didn't want to get into a long discussion about it by any means, but I congratulate the Health and Wellness Department. Keep it up. Try your best to educate the people of the town, because it's so important. The only other thing I have, Mr. Chairman, I go by that North Scituate parking lot, the one where the tennis courts are, and again, I bring this up. We talk about this every year or so. There almost has to be something else we can do with that parking lot. It's just vacant. And I don't know what. I saw it in the paper the other day that Sharon increased the price of the MBTA parking lot. Now, I don't know whether it was their parking lot. You know, I just don't know. Can we sell tickets, sell parking there? I don't know. I think it's just it's a wasteland right now. It's doing absolutely no good. No one's parking in it. Just maybe I could ask the town administrator when she gets back.
Can you put in a note to ask? Because we swapped that for this.
I thought they actually pay to be there, Joe, except on the weekends it's free for town residents. That's the secret, if you want to go and get without. But I thought there was a company that collects.
No.
For
nobody collects for.
But because nobody's parking there, because they're not using the train. Yeah. That's what my understanding was, is that
I think that was initially the way we started, but it got to the point where no one used it, so.
Right.
Was the company still paying?
Are you thinking?
It happened. I think initially the agreement was with the T was that we would have to charge what they charged at their lot.
Right.
Now, I don't know how long we're locked into that, but if there were some way to, like, they're charging $4 to park over in the lot, if we could charge two or
a resident,
resident type of
$3. I mean, anything, $2, if we could do that, wouldn't that be a good use for it? I don't know. Well, maybe we could ask the town
administrator. Let's look into it.
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Right. Just a quick reminder, 3:31 from 9 to 3, you can throw your electronics away at the dump for free. Also, a quick note, there's a Patterson road race that has occurred every year for about 10 years, and they've graciously passed that road race over to the Scituate school system for them to run it, with the donations going equally to all the schools. So I've been asked to thank the Patterson family for their passing that along, and know that the donations will go to a strong cause, including their son, who was the one that they started the race for. Other than that, again, congratulations to the basketball team. It's quite a feat to get to the high school. And also, more importantly, thank you to the firefighters. They did a phenomenal job and made what could have been a huge catastrophe to a small catastrophe. And thank goodness the wind was blowing the right direction. But they responded in about 6 or 7 minutes and got there. And at that point in time, all four houses were completely engulfed in flames. So they did a phenomenal job keeping that under control, and we're lucky to have them there. Anything else? Okay. Approve the minutes.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the regular and executive session minutes for March 1st, 2012.
There was an adjustment I asked for.
Right.
Okay.
As amended.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
And
Kim, this next minutes, Mr. Danahy and Mr. Norton were not present, so we don't have a quorum. Do we have to wait?
Yes, you do.
Okay. Move the Board of Selectmen vote to adjourn the meeting at 9:48 p.m.
Second by Mr. Norton.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, folks. Thank you, Zach.